couple of showers during the day, but it's generally fine, and the athletics is sure to be outstanding. It's about 18 degrees Celsius, and once again, we have a massive crowd here ready for the action. Five sets of medals will be determined today. In the field, we've got the women's discus and the men's long jump. On the track, after semi-finals of the men's 40-meter hurdles and women's 100 and 400 meters, we have the finals of the men's 10,000 meters and those women's 100 meters. And the conclusion of the women's heptathlon, with Jessica Ennis, golden girl of British athletics, heading clearly for gold. Well, with me, welcome to Stuart Story and to John Trower. So good evening, gentlemen.
Well, good evening. And once again, it's an absolutely packed house here in the Olympic Stadium. The crowds have really supported the athletics program really well, and they've been entertained on the big screen at big screens at either end of this stadium, and to give them some focus as we run up to the start of the program, there are a couple of victory ceremonies scheduled for the 20-kilometer race walk and also the women's 10,000 meters. The race walk completed today, but the 10,000 meters finished last night, of course, with a fantastic run by Tilanish Dibaba of Ethiopia, and we'll see her get her gold medal and retaining her title she won in Beijing in 2008. But as far as the track is concerned, well, all the big names are there in the 100 and the 400 meter for women and the 400 meter hurdles. But in the field, John, what's happening there?
Well, we've got to we're looking forward to the women's discus final, the first field event that's on the program this evening, and then that's followed by the men's long jump. They'll be at one point running together, and we'll be keeping an eye on that. It's interesting, again, I sort of make a point of saying what the wind is like, because in the field events it's a crucial factor, and in the stadium that are as large as this, you know, it does change the dynamics of the wind. You know, it's coming in from one direction, hits the stadium, comes down, and then actually just flows around.
So we come to the women's 10,000 meters victory ceremony, the first set of medals to be determined on the track in the first day of competition. We also had the men's shot put, and we'll also have the victory ceremony for that later today. This was a truly great race, and a truly great, all-time great champion who will step up onto that rostrum very shortly. Just a few seats remaining to be filled around this mighty stadium here, but most of the crowd are in and ready for the action. So here we come with the medalists in the women's 10,000 meters. The Ethiopian flanked by two Kenyans. This is Bahani of Ethiopia, member of the IOC, to make the presentation and the flowers presented by Isaiah Kiplagat, the IAF council member there. Very fitting pair, of course, with the medals going to the East African powerhouses of distance running. So the bronze medal goes to the woman who was the dominant distance runner last year, having to settle this time for a bronze medal at 10,000, Vivian Cherrier, her first ever defeat on the track at 10,000 metres. She'll be back, of course, for the 5,000 later. And the silver medal going just as it did in the World Championships last year for Sally Kipyego of Kenya. And well, though the Kenyans ran throughout the race, there was nothing they could do with the stunning 62-second last lap by one of the all-time greats of women's athletics, Tirunesh Dibaba, retaining her title and adding gold to the two she's also won at World Championships. A very great distance runner, after a timeout through injury, absolutely back at her best, a brilliant winner. So our first gold medal on the track goes to Tirunesh Dibaba, an outstanding run, and indeed the fastest time in the world at the 10,000 meter distance this year. Dibaba joined on the top of the rostrum by the two Kenyan medalists, Kipyego and Cheruiyot. Cheruiyot will be back in the 5,000, and maybe Dibaba too. She's down as a reserve for it, and there's quite a lot of speculation that she may run in the Ethiopian team.
Well, we have a shot now of the warm-up track, and the athletes who are coming up into the main stadium soon will be warming up conscientiously. Alison Felix there, the second heat of this 100 meters. Better known over 200 and 400 meters. She's really sub 11 now over 100 meters. And then, of course, Veronica Campbell-Brown of Jamaica, twice Olympic champion at 200 meters, tries her hand here at 100. She's been a world champion in three sprint events. And Carmeleta Jetta, very impressive in qualification at 10.83. Very, very impressive indeed. And Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce, the defending Olympic champion, getting last minute treatment. It's loosening off. But meanwhile, in the stadium itself, we've got the first semi-final of the men's 400 meter hurdles. And as one would expect, it's a pretty solid lineup in here. We'll bring you that lineup in a moment. There it is. Alejandro of Puerto Rico drawn in lane one. Then Bulhiel of Belgium in two. Felix Sanchez of the Dominican Republic in three. Jeho Gordon, Trinidad in four. Karen Clement of the United States in six. I should be saying 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And then Di Green in lane seven. And Kurt Kuto of Mozambique in lane eight. Alejandro, lane one not being used, just to avoid the confusion. So he's on the inside in lane two. Best of 49.36 set this season. Next to him, Bulhiel of Belgium. He's got a best of 49.18, the World Student Games bronze medalist a couple of seasons or so ago, European Championship semi-final. There's Felix Sanchez, a man who won the Olympic title back in, 2004 in Athens. One of the comeback athletes, really. And then Jeho Gordon of Trinidad and Tobago, fourth place in the World Championships in 2009. He was just 17 years old. Hasn't improved a great deal yet. But Karen Clement, twice world champion, was the only individual to successfully defend his world title in Berlin in 2009. And now we have the world champion, Di Green of Great Britain. The response emphatic. Kuto of Mozambique on the outside in the eighth lane. Mozambican record holder at 100, 400 and 400 hurdles. And then we've got Han of Senegal, second in the African Championships this year. 49.04, his best time. The first two plus the two fastest to the final on Monday. And this is the first heat in the semi-final round. There are three heats. And so Di Green, very, very solid in his preparation, both mentally and physically. Alejandro, Bulhiel, Sanchez, Gordon, Clement, Green, Kuto and Han. The first heat of the semi-final round of the men's 400 meter hurdles. Well, Clement was slowly away, but not a lot in it, I must say. Jeho Gordon going off very quickly and right on the outside. Han going very strongly indeed. And Felix Sanchez going well. But Di Green's run a very good first 200 metres, but still not a lot in it as they go through the 200 metre mark. Karen Clement now coming up on side Green, right on the outside. Han still in contention now as they come through to 300 metres, and Di Green is strong over the final part of the race, that's for sure. And he's got a very, very strong finish. But look at Felix Sanchez on the inside. Sanchez is looking very, very strong indeed. It's the first two to go through, and them fastest losers, and this is a surprise, really. Sanchez gets there. Jeho Gordon in second place, and in third place was Karen Clement, and Di Green was in fourth, and that could be a problem with just two fastest losers to go through. And the time 47.76, and Di Green, well, you can see the disappointment on his face. He had to get in the first two, and Sanchez is back. What a performance by him. But that was, from the British viewpoint, not the result they wanted. The world champion is distraught on the track at the moment, because there could be problems there, and I think probably there will be. but not for Felix Sanchez. Look at this, he came through brilliantly, and Di Green didn't have the power that he normally does in the home straight.
It was a fantastic run by Sanchez. He went off hard, he led at the 200 meter point, and he just kept going away, and he's run a fantastic time, 47.76. This was a race of three world champions, and they came here first, third, and fourth, with Gordon setting a national record for Trinidad, 47.96. It's very fast, though, so both Clement and Green, previous world champions, have every chance of going through, 48.12 and 48.19, respectively. A very, very fast opening semi-final.
Yes, it was indeed, but, you know, those are the two times you've got to watch if you're a British fan, 48.12 and 48.19 for the two fastest losers, and that was a disappointing run. There was nothing in the tank in the home straight, which is very, very surprising. Well, have another look at this. It was a good lane for Di Green. Clement put pressure on him, that's for sure, but Felix Sanchez on the inside, his transition into the home straight was absolutely superb. It's a good run by Jehu Gordon of Trinidad as well. He's the sets a national record of 47.96. We can't ask more than that. Clement's not a great hurdler, I have to say that. He's not majestic in that respect, but he can run well under 45 flat for 400 meters, and that's where his strength comes from. But when you look at the Olympic champion from 2004, is twice world champion, Felix Sanchez of the Dominican Republic. Well, he is back. That's a huge improvement on his season's best. He came here with a best of 48.56. Well, this is the way to do it. And he looks fit, doesn't he? But Di's struggling. You can see the look on his face. He is hurting.
Well, he was fourth coming into the home straight, and he didn't gain any more after that. And that's usually the best bit of his race. But a fantastic run by Sanchez nonetheless. He was dominant in the early part, 10 years ago, 2000 to 2004, world number one. And now, 8 years later, here he is. As we look at the warm-up track again, we've got the women's 400-meter semi-final later today. We'll take a look at some of the favorites out there on that warm-up track in just a moment. Defending champion, Christina Horogu, taking last-minute instructions from Lloyd Cowan.
Yeah, they've been together a long time, these two. And that's Moncho, Mantle Moncho, who Christina Horogu beat in London at the Diamond League. But she will take some beating this time, but I reckon the favourite, Sanya Richards-Ross, the American. When you can run close to 22 flat for 200 metres, then you've got an awful lot. And she learned a lot from her failing in 2007 in Osaka when she went off far too quickly. And, you know, the Russians are in Shapka. She's the fastest in the world this year on paper, that is. And she went off like a rocket in her heat, very determined to impress, and did so. There were very different forms of qualification there. But there's the result. Sanchez, Gordon, and with Clement and Di Green, those are the two fastest loser times at the moment, and we've got to keep a close eye on that, because it is only the two fastest losers that go through.
As we come now to the second of the three semi-finals, we have Medwood of Belize, Thomas of Australia, Green, Jack Green, that is, of Britain, Colson of Puerto Rico, Bekric of Serbia, Taylor of USA, Melnikov of Ukraine, and Cisneros of Cuba. So once again, a very talented group, including the double Olympic champion, Angelo Taylor, just coming into shot there, who will run for the United States of America in lane 7. Well, he won in Sydney, had the inside lane on that occasion. Nowadays, the athletes are seeded into the center lanes, but this is the man who's the favorite for the title. You may have been shocked to see just how good Felix Sanchez is, of course. But Colson is undefeated this year. Headed the world list coming here at 47.78, but Sanchez has just gone quicker than that, of course. This is the Puerto Rican who's been the silver medalist in the last two world championships. So from Belize, we have Kenneth Medwood, who's won the Central American title this year. Man with a best of 49.54. Ran quite close to that time, 49.78, in his heat yesterday. Then Tristan Thomas of Australia, whose top credential is winning the World University title 3 years ago. In lane four, we have the very promising British athlete, second to Di Green in the British Championships. This is Jack Green, last year's European under-23 title. Tall man, ideally suited for the hurdles. Then Javier Colson, 47.72 is national record, 47.78 he's run this year, and he ran very fast, 48.33, just to make this semi-final. This is a fast improving man, Emir Bekric of Serbia. He ran a national record at the European Championships, and he was the silver medalist, and he further improved that yesterday to 49.21. Angelo Taylor, he's been at the forefront for over a decade now, winning the Olympic title in 2000 and in 2008. And he made the US team this year, taking second place in their trials. Stanislav Melnikov of Ukraine, twice a European Championship bronze medalist. He goes in lane eight. The field completed by the Cuban record holder, 47.99, making him the third fastest on personal best in this lineup for semi-final number two. So it's Kenneth Medwood of Belize, Tristan Thomas of Australia, Jack Green of Britain, Javier Coulson here of Puerto Rico, Emir Bekric of Serbia, Angelo Taylor, USA, Stanislav Melnikov, Ukraine, and Omar Cisneros for Cuba. Another side number there to help on the judging of the photo finish for Tristan Thomas of Australia. Lane three. Semi-final number two of the 400-meter hurdles. To determine which two will go through to the final, and we'll just see how the times of the rest compare with 48.12 and 48.17 from semi-final one. 48.19, I should say. Well, Carlson, the favorite, goes in lane five here in the red top of Puerto Rico, and he's already up on Bekric outside him, so a good start. Also, Angelo Taylor, the American experienced international, is going very well indeed in lane seven. It's Coulson, and Taylor's a faller though on the inside. That's sad, of course, but meanwhile, the favorites are out there. Angelo Taylor and Javier Coulson. Jack Green of Britain has fallen, so it's not going right for Great Britain in this event. But up front, it's Angelo Taylor of the USA from Javier Coulson and Cisneros of Cuba. The three men who've broken 48 seconds are the first three in this race, but it's only two short to go through, and it's Coulson looking quite easy, taking it from Taylor with Cisneros in third. It's another mighty fast time, 47.95, and of course we're going to be interested to see what the time is for Cisneros in third place. Coulson, Taylor, Cisneros. 47.93, in fact, the official winning time for Coulson. Angelo Taylor has made yet another Olympic final. He's run 47.95, and Cisneros 48.23. Well, he's not made it. It's a very good time indeed, but it's not as quick as three and four in semi-final one. But here's Jack Green.
Let's see what happened to him. Oh, his lead leg, he hit it with his lead leg, and that means he's out of it. He's hurt himself on that. Once hurdlers, I think he's damaged himself on that. He hit the first hurdle with his lead leg, and then the rest of the race unfolded with Angelo Taylor, as always, way up there, with Coulson just marking him. But the man in third place, that Cisneros, 48.23, season's best, but he's not going to go through because the other two, Di Green is faster than that, the British world champion. But Coulson looked very comfortable, didn't he?
And Jack Green has walked off okay, so he's just making his way out of the stadium now, so no permanent damage. He may run in the relay team later on in these championships, but of course he must be bitterly disappointed not to be contending here. As it is, the two favourites, Coulson and Taylor, are through to the final.
Yes, it does matter which one of them wins, in fact, because of the seeding and the opportunity to get a good lane. But Colson certainly is unbeaten still this season. So I think we're going to have a look at the discus for the moment, John.
Well, in the warm-up, they're just going through the order, which is what they tend to do, two warm-up throws prior to stopping everything 10 minutes in before the competition. This is Samuels, who's in the circle at the moment. This is Stephanie Brown-Trafton, who's the Olympic champion from Beijing. And here's the Cuban Barrios, who's won the silver in Beijing. So we got the gold and silver medalist from 2008. Muller from Germany. And here is Pishkelnikova from Russia, who will be the hot favorite for this event. Perkovic from Croatia has been incredibly consistent all season. And she was the European Championship championship winner in 2010 and more recently in 2012.
Well, Colson really is a fine act for the rest to follow. And there is 47.93, Angelo Taylor, 47.95. You can't write him off. You really can't. He's won the title twice. So Angelo Taylor back in some sort of form. My goodness me, the Olympic Games does bring out the best and the worst. There's the lineup for the third heat of the semi-final round. LaRue of Slovenia, Williams of Great Britain, Green of Jamaica, Tinsley of the United States, Cole of Australia, Valle of Cuba, De Leon of Italy, and Morton of Nigeria, drawn right on the outside. Well, Michael Tinsley, the American here, we'll have to see how he goes. He was not impressive in London, I must say. He was way, way down on the field on that occasion. Well, royal attendance once again. Duke and Duchess of Cambridge. But 3258 is Michael Tinsley. He's fourth in the 2011 American Championships, but then he won the trials, and that's all that matters. And here's a man on the inside, the Slovenian. He's actually a decathlete as well. He's quite a useful one. 49.38, his best time. And then we've got Rhys Williams. At the moment, Di Green, the world champion, looks okay with the second of the two fastest loser times. But Rhys Williams, the Welshman, very good, the European champion after bronze in 2006 and silver in 2010. He runs inside Clifford Green of Jamaica. He's three times the Jamaican champion, this fella, 48.88 this season. But my goodness me, the times are being revised rapidly in this on this occasion. Michael Tinsley won his heat, 49.13. Couldn't tell a lot from that. But Brendan Cole of Australia, twice the Australian champion, came through very strongly in the final stages of his heat, if I remember correctly. And then Valle of Cuba, he's drawn in the seventh lane, 49.19, won his heat, 49.19, that was equal to his personal best. And then right in De Leon of Italy, well, De Leon is a 49.33 man. And right on the outside is the Nigerian, Amechi Morton, the African champion this season, the best personal best set this season of 48.79. Just to remind you, the first two to go through, plus fastest losers, to the final. So it's pretty tough. It's a very tough qualification, actually. But Tinsley, surrounded by a Jamaican and an Australian, with Rhys Williams, a good lane for him, drawn in lane three. So lanes 2 to 9 again. LaRue, Williams, Green, Tinsley, Cole, Valle, De Leon, and Morton. The third heat of the semi-final round of the men's 400 meter hurdles. First two go through by right. Let's see who rises. Well, Tinsley's gone off pretty quickly. That, apart from Tinsley, it's pretty even, I would think. Rhys Williams has got a little bit of work to do, but the Green, the Jamaican, running well. He's running very strongly as they approach 200 metres. And right on the outside, Morton, the Nigerian, he'll be run down shortly. De Leon of Italy going quite strongly at the moment. But Tinsley will have the advantage of the bend as he comes in. And right inside him, Leiford Green of Jamaica is running very strongly indeed. And Morton's gone. He's stopped on the outside. But he's overstriding a bit, is Green. But it's a very fun run. Green's going to take this, I think, from Tinsley. Oh, no, Tinsley's got the stronger motion off that last hurdle. Tinsley wins it. Green in second. In third place was Leroux. In fourth place was Rhys Williams. 48.18. So it looks as though the world champion is there, Di Green. But Tinsley, but certainly Morton didn't survive the race. He went out at about just before 300 metres, I would think. He stopped hurdling, hit a hurdle, and that was it. So Michael Tinsley, the third of the Americans through. And Leiford Green very nicely through as well. But just look at this again. Just look at it. Yes, the Nigerian went out at that stage, didn't he?
Well, it was a strong run. It was a weaker semi-final than the other two, no question about that. Strong run by Tinsley, because Green was leading at this point, but Tinsley did enough to come through. I think the disappointment will be for Cisneros of Cuba. He ran 48.23 and he won't make it, and that's much quicker than Green has done here, 48.61. But nothing like the same class of the first semi-final, for instance.
No, indeed, and it means that Kerren Clement of the United States and Di Green of Great Britain from the first heat with 48.12 and 48.19 do qualify for the final, but they certainly won't get seeded lanes, that's for sure. But still another chance. And that's important. Tinsley, though, a surprise winner of the US trials, I have to say that. Angelo Taylor faltered in the final stages, but Tinsley managed to come through it. He's the best hurdler, I must admit, Tinsley. I like the way he hurdles. He's obviously a high hurdler as well. He gets that lead leg up. Have a look at this. Really nice, flexible approach to the hurdles. Just watch him again, he's got a good lead leg, look at that, nice, comes off well with the trail leg, drives him into the bend, into the transition. But Green at the moment, at this point of the race, looked as though he'd got it, but I said at the time he was overstriding. He really was desperate to get to the hurdle, and when he got to the hurdle, okay, but then momentum off the hurdle wasn't great. He is looking behind, but I often feel that can be a little bit of an excuse at times. I don't think he was going to win that anyway, but certainly the result, so the men's long jump finalists going out onto the arena, I think that is. There's Mr. Watt, yes it is. Tomlinson is there, and Rutherford for Great Britain, two Britons following Watt, the Australian, who I fancy in that competition, quite frankly. But the 100 metre athletes going flat out in their attempt to get themselves through, warm enough to get through. Jetta jetting up and down as always, and really John Smith will have had long chats with her since the first round, although she was very, very fast in the first round. They do tend to do that, John Smith's athletes. They go for it in the first round, and then we'll see. Men's shot ceremony coming up.
Well, it will be a very proud moment for these three competitors now coming out to the podium.
A fantastic battle between the top two particularly, and they were well clear in fact of the rest. Medal presented by Gordon Peterson of Sweden of the IOC, the flowers by Darlan Al-Hamad, IF Vice President.
And they're all looking pretty serious. There's Darlan Al-Hamad, the Vice President of the IAAF. And there you have the shot putters lined up. The difference in height between Hoffer and the German style and is quite stark. Rhys Hoffer, bronze medal for the US of A. He couldn't quite get into the competition for the higher medals. He wasn't without trying, but he, as hard as he tried, He got over that 21 meter line, but it wasn't quite enough. But I think he's going to be pretty happy with that bronze medal. And awarded the flowers there. And I can tell you now that those corns, cobs, those dried corns in there come from a field at the back of my house in Shropshire. So David Stoll from Germany, the 22-year-old, he's got an appetite for performing at the best at the championships. He peaks at these games, and he was just so unlucky just to find the man who's going to take the gold just in slightly better form. So Stoll from Germany takes the silver medal, and a very proud moment, and the start of his Olympic career. So Majewski from Poland celebrates winning the gold medal, repeating what he achieved in Beijing in 2008. He really is a colossus. He's a big man, and he's taken away the biggest medal from the shot put from London 2012. And he's got a pretty wide smile on his face too. What a fantastic achievement. And not only that, when he knew he'd won the event, he actually put his best put on the sixth and final round.
It's funny that the two linear technicians beat the rotators on this occasion. There are so few of them around on in these days. There really are. But it does show that the series they can put together, as they demonstrated in that final yesterday, is very, very solid.
Very consistent, Stuart. And I think it does tend to suit the taller male, though. The taller men go for the linear style. Whereas the shorter guys, you know, just do prefer that spinning technique. But a great performance by all medalists. And here we have the long jump finalists entering the arena. There'll be some nerves jangling as they make their trip across the stadium to the long jump areas. And I was just looking at the wind. It's as is typical in evenings in England around this time. You can have a bit of a wind earlier on in the day that lasts until around 6 or 7 o'clock, and then it just dies down. And looking at it earlier, it actually was a slight tailwind that was perhaps going to help these long jumpers in their competition. And now we have the women's discus final. You can see there that the world record was set in 1988 and is 76.80. And the Olympic record was set by Martina Hellman in 1988 as well at the Seoul Olympics. The start list comes up, and they'll be introducing the athletes as we move along the list. The first up to throw will be Stephanie Brown-Trafton, which is good timing for her because she's the defending Olympic champion. So she's won from Beijing.
And yesterday, of course, we had two defending champions winning, so that might give her a boost. So she's about to be introduced to the crowd. That's the first athlete there, Stephanie Brown-Trafton, 67.74. She's done a personal best this year.
And next in line, so there's Stephanie Brown-Trafton, the defending Olympic champion. And as Peter suggested, it could be a continuing theme with two winners from Beijing yesterday. And obviously the Polish shot putter, Malewski. Here's Robert Michon from France. And Samuels from Australia, the world champion from 2009. And next is Muller, who ranks second in the world this year with 68.89. So she's been in good form. Zanaya Sendriet of Lithuania. She's got a best of 64.03 in 2012. Yangfan Li of China, 67.84 in 2012. And then we have Barrios. She won the silver from Cuba in Beijing in 2008 behind the American Brown-Trafton. So Pishkalinikova of Russia, she's thrown over 70 meters this year. Shui Mua of China. And from Croatia, we have Perkovic. And she's been very consistent and is the European champion from 2010 and 2012. Anna Ruh from Germany is number 11. And then finally, we have Punya from India, who is the reigning Commonwealth champion from 2010.
And just to note, it's good to see Ruh has made the final world junior champion.
Absolutely. She's 19 years old and is...
We'll just come back to that in a moment. There is the result of the third semi-final of the 400-meter hurdles, the slowest of the three, Tinsley and LaFord Green, going through to the final, and they were well clear of the rest of the field. One disqualification, though, I just noticed, in the third placer originally.
Well, Sanchez, there are the qualifiers for the final. Sanchez, Coulson, Taylor, Gordon, Clement, Tinsley, and Dye Green and LeFord Green.
Three Americans, four from the Caribbean, and one from Europe.
I'm just trying to work out who's missing, and I think, no, Jeho Gordon is there.
Oh, they're all, that's all.
They're
that's,
all,
that's
there. They're
as,
all
as,
there.
That's as we expect.
Yes, okay. So that's going to be one very, very good final indeed. Discus, though, underway.
Yep, Stephanie Brown-Trafton, she's the defending champion from Beijing, and she's first up into the circle this evening to commence this discus final for women. Active reverse at the front of the circle. Well, it's not going to set any world records, but it'll settle her nerves because a reasonable opener from the American. You can see here the feet split in that circle. The right foot swings around and goes into the circle, and she does this active reverse around the front foot, keeping the hand high and on top of that discus to get the flight that the discus needs to sail in through the night air. So we're just waiting for the distance to come up. ...63.01 for Brown-Trafton in the first round, first throw of the competition.
Meanwhile, on the track, we have the women's 100 metres. We have three semi-finals, so as usual, it's the first two in each, and then two more on times will progress to the final, which is the last event later on today.
Well, there are the records. Forget those for the moment. They're outstanding records. They really are both the world record and the Olympic record. And the first of the three heats of this semi-final round already out, and it includes Carmeleta Jetta, and we'll introduce her in a moment. And there it is. Oyapitan of Great Britain, Pove of Ukraine, Campbell Brown of Jamaica, Hackett of Trinidad and Tobago, Jetta of the United States, Santos of Brazil, Jones Ferret of the US Virgin Islands, and then Zhang Milama of Gabon, right on the outside. There's Jetta, world champion last year. And what a tussle she had with Campbell Brown. Campbell Brown won the 200, she won the 100, and they were second to each other in those two races. It was quite incredible. Right on the inside, Abiodun Oyapitan of Great Britain. A lot of injury problems, but she's been in a final before. She got into the final in 2004. And when she can avoid injury, she is very, very useful indeed. She'll find this tough, though. Pove of the Ukraine next to her. Third in her heat, 11:18. European indoor champion last year. Well, here's Veronica Campbell Brown of Jamaica, twice Olympic champion at 200 metres. She's now been world champion at 60, 100 and 200 metres. 10:94 in qualification. It's pretty good. And here's Hackett, at Seymour Hackett, the Central American and Caribbean champion at 100 metres. Seymour Hackett of Trinidad and Tobago. And now Carmeleta Jetta, the fastest qualifier here with 10.83. She was absolutely flying. And Santos of Brazil next to her. Well attired, isn't she? Anchored Brazil to the fourth place in the Olympic 4x1 in 2008. She's only 17 then. There's Laverne Jones-Ferret of the US Virgin Islands, their record holder at the four sprints actually, up to 400 metres from 60. And then Zhang, the African champion at 100 metres, right on the outside in lane number 9. So Oyapitan in 2, Pove in 3, Campbell Brown 4, Hackett 5, Jetta 6, Santos 7, Jones-Ferret 8, Zhang Milama in lane 9. First heat, semi-final round of the women's 100 metres. The final later on this evening. Carmeleta Jetta settles. Last little look. First two to go through by right, and then two fastest losers. Well, no problem with the start. Campbell Brown got away well, didn't she? And Jetta will come through later on, but Campbell Brown and Jetta now is motoring, and Campbell Brown, these two. Jetta's going to take this. Campbell Brown in second place, and 10.82. It's even faster if that's confirmed. Jetta 1, Campbell Brown 2. The script was listened to, was adhered to. The two best, the two world-class sprinters prevailed. But Jetta, the second half of her race, is considerable, and you can see Campbell Brown as a 200 meter specialist a little bit slower away, but my goodness me.
Well, Campbell Brown low and then rising high, she had the early advantage, but now look at Jetta when she gets into full stream, and the rest of the field is close, but they were way behind, 3 meters perhaps more, as Jetta took it from Campbell Brown. Well, what a final this is going to be, but certainly two of the big favorites here. Jetta very upright here, but such power as she comes past Campbell Brown, who of course for over a decade has been one of the supreme sprinters in world women's athletics.
That was a good performance too by Rosalina Santos of Brazil, who came through into third place there.
And into the circle comes Nadine Müller from Germany. She's second ranked in the world this year with 68.89. demonstrating that fixed feet style of throwing. That's over 65 meters. So a good start for Muller. Swinging that right leg round, drives into that left foot block, stops, just stands up. And along with Brown Trafton there, the tallest athletes in this final at 6'3". So over 65 meters for Muller of Germany, 65-71, and she goes into the lead in this early stages of this competition.
Well, here's Carmelita Jetta winning that race, and really does look impressive. The wind was nil. There's the result.
Yeah, it is a very good run indeed. Look, 10.89 for Veronica Campbell-Brown too. So, and Santos and Jones-Ferret, 11.17, 11.22. They're the two fastest loser spots we'll keep an eye on, but we'll see.
I just think it's interesting that there was zero wins. We look back on the discus.
Pishna Chalinikova, first round in the discus. The world lead in 2012. And she seemed to stumble at the front of the circle. She shakes her head because she warmed up with over 66 meters and swings around and then seems to lose her balance at the front of the circle, flexes at those hips and leans down. And it just about goes over the 65 meter line. And 65.19, and that puts her into second place.
But John, with no wind at all out there, obviously the discus throwers like to have a slight quartering wind coming in at them. This is good throwing over 65 meters.
It is, and I think there is a slight wind. I was looking in the binoculars just now, and there is a bit of a headwind coming in. So this is Ma of China coming in for her first round throw. And Ma extending the discus to go over that 60 meter line. She's got a best of 63.91 this year. Big swing out of that right foot. Active reverse on delivery. Still looking after that discus. Reasonable flight, just turning up a little bit. So aerodynamically it will be impeded if there is a bit of a wind. 61.02, and she currently lies in seventh with two more competitors to go in this round. And the next up is Perkovic from Croatia. She is the current European champion in 2012, and she was also the winner in 2010, the youngest ever winner of that championship. And it looked as though if it was going to go flying further than 65 meters, but it seemed to come down to earth fairly quickly. But a good start by the young Croatian. Very long arms, good swing of that right, and again she's fixed feet. You can see that she drives that right leg, that hip, into the left leg block, and it just comes down on the 65 meter line. Oh, just under that, 64.58, a good start by Perkovic.
100 meters, we now come to the second semi-final. Brilliant sprinting in the first from Jetta and Campbell-Brown. There's the lineup for semi-final two, and it features more top names. The defending champion, Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce in two. The double silver medalist at the Olympics at 200 meters, Alison Felix, going in four. Felix not able to double up at 200 and 400, this time, and has chosen to do the 100 and the 200. So from the inside, we have Shaniqua Ferguson of Bahamas, world junior bronze medalist and indeed winner at 200 meters 4 years ago. What a best of 11.07. Next to her, the fast-starting Norwegian, Ezinok Paraibo, who improved her national record to 11.14 in qualifying for these semi-finals. Then we have Alison Felix, a beautiful sprinter. Has she got the start that can contend with the top athletes? 11.01 in qualifying, 10.92 her personal best. Marvellous collection of world titles as well, of course. Then Kellyanne Baptiste, Well, she was third in the World Championships last year, and she broke 11 seconds to win her heat. Now we have the defending champion, the diminutive figure, the ever happy, Shelley Ann Fraser-Pryce, also world champion in 2009. And she's got a best of 10.70 when she won the Jamaican title this year. Yvette Laliver has come back from serious injury to be in good form, European champion this year, and was fourth in the Olympics 8 years ago. Olga Bludova of Kazakhstan, well, she's taken the national record down from 11.37 to 11.12 this year. And the field completed by the US-based Nigerian Gloria Asumnu, world indoor finalist, personal best of 11.03 set 4 years ago. Defending champion Shelley Ann Fraser-Pryce takes to her blocks in the second semi-final, running in lane six. It's Ferguson, Okparagbo, Felix, Baptiste, Fraser-Pryce, Laliver, Bludova and Asumnu. Well, there's some very good starters here like Okparagbo and Fraser-Pryce. How will Felix compare against them? Well, certainly Baptiste away very well, so too Fraser-Pryce. Felix just a little behind them. Fraser-Pryce now coming through, and it's the Jamaican who's going to win this, and it's Alison Felix gets up for second with Baptiste in third place, and it's another outstanding run, not quite as quick as semi-final one, but 10.86, once again, brilliant sprinting. What a final we're going to have later. Shelley Ann Fraser-Pryce showing that as defending champion, she's once again in top form there, and Felix just coming up into second place. She'll go into the final, and Baptiste may well join her because she's run 11 seconds as well.
Well, certainly Shelley Ann Fraser-Pryce got a start, didn't she? She really is a rocket once she gets away, but she's got the strength endurance and the speed endurance in the final stage. Look, she's easing down, and that's a 10.85. And you have to say that she made that a little bit look a little bit easier. Look how relaxed she is. The diminutive figure compared with some, she's absolutely flying. Felix comes through to take the second qualification, but really her expertise comes at 200. But 10.85, 10.94 and 11 for Baptiste in third place, and 11.10. So Santos and Jones Ferret have gone, actually. It's those two fastest losers are better in that second semi-final.
Second round throw for Stephanie Brown Trafton of the US of A. 63.01 in that first round. And it's long, but it just goes outside the sector. You can see the judge standing there with his arms out. That indicates he's gone out the sector. But that is the first place, that red line on the screen. So you can see if she'd got that inside the sector, she would have taken the lead. So a frustrating no throw, bit of a rueful smile. And she just pulled that round a little bit, and she may have been looking to see if she could catch the wind. Well, she caught the wind, if she was, and it just took it outside the sector. No throw on her second attempt.
Well, here's a replay of that race, and what a fine start and what a fine run throughout. And as Stuart said, very relaxed towards the finish by Fraser-Pryce. Felix was only 0.02 outside her personal best at 100 metres as she comes past Baptiste. I think Baptiste's time will be enough to take her into the final. Very much quicker than anything we saw in third and fourth in the previous race.
Yes, they're both Kellyanne Baptiste and Izine Okparagbo will certainly be the two fastest losers from this thus far, but with one heat in this semi-final round to go.
Yes, Okparagbo, of course, set another Norwegian record. She too was out very fast in the red vest there. Norwegian record in both heat and semi-final here. As we take a check on the result, here's Shelley Ann Fraser-Pryce winning in 10.85, Alison Felix 10.94, and then Baptiste and Okparagbo keeping themselves in the hunt in 11 seconds and 11.10.
Well, the standard is incredibly high, but one would expect that in a competition such as this.
Nadine Muller, second attempt in the discus. She went 65-71 in the first round. She's the current leader. 1.93 meters. She is a very tall young lady. Fixed feet, long arms and a jump on release. And it wings its way out into the London, East London air. And you can see it comes down very close to that 65 meter line, and 65.06. So she's putting together a very promising series, and she leads currently as we start and just get started in this second round. So the next up will be Zinaida Sendrit from Lithuania, 7 times Lithuanian champion. Very neat and tidy in the circle, out of balance on release, and she gets the red flag on her second attempt. 61.68 on her first throw. She lost control, lost balance, and couldn't stop herself from falling out the front of the circle. That's a no throw.
So here we are then with the final heat in the semi-final round of the women's 100 meters. And I tell you, this is going to be a very, very tight one indeed. That's Madison, Tiana Madison of the United States, who is a best of 10.96 coming into this championship. Just a hundredth outside of that, actually. But there are the two fastest losers I gave it, Baptiste and Ocparebo, so far. So we've got to look at the third and fourth places in this final heat to see whether those two times actually do stand up. But there it is. Aye of Trinidad, Grinkait of Lithuania, Sumari of France, Ahure of the Ivory Coast, Madison of the United States, Okabari of Nigeria, a Stewart of Jamaica, and Sailor of Germany right on the outside. Well, just meeting Aye of Trinidad and Tobago, 11.28 in qualifying, her best is 11.19 though, enjoying this moment. Grinkait of Lithuania, she's drawn in the third lane next to Ai. She's got a best of 11.19. Sumari, the French woman, in the fourth lane, was a bronze medalist in the European Championships over 200 meters just before these championships, a best of 11.07. Ahure, very, very solid citizen Ahure this year. She's set national records, Ivory Coast national records in 1 and 200 meters, Ahure. Well, Madison, Tiana Madison, she won the World Long Jump Championship back in 2005 at the age of 19. Okabari of Nigeria is next to her. One in Monaco just before these championships, 10.93. She equaled her personal best in qualification for this semi-final. Karen Stewart, world and Olympic silvers at 100 meters. Third in her heat, needs to get away a little bit better. And Verena Sailer of Germany, golds at 2 success at the European Championships, got the 100 in 2010, was a member of the relay team in 2012. But Madison being featured here. But watch out for Ahure, the Ivory Coast, and next to her, because she has been running very, very strongly indeed, and could well go under the 11 seconds again, 10.99 in qualification. Majestic athlete, Sailor on the near side. Ai, Grinkait, Sumari, Ahure, Madison, Okabari, Stewart, and Sailor. Heat 3 in the semi-final round of the women's 100 metres. First two go through by right. Madison got away well, so did Ahure, and Ahure looks to me to be putting a real pressure on Ahure, and here comes Madison. Madison coming past, and look at Okabari, look at this. Oh, Madison got it, I think, and Okabari of Nigeria was there as well. What a finish by the Nigerian. Wow, 10.92 the time, but Okabari really flew. She won the race in Monaco, and it'd be very interesting to see who got that, because it was very tight on the line. I think it was the Nigerian. She was very, very quick in the finish. Yes, she was, 10.92, a personal best in qualifying. Madison, 10.92 as well, both given the same time. And just looking at third place, 11.01. Well, that's definitely in as a, well, actually 11 seconds. It's the second fastest qualifier it is at the moment as we watch Ahure. Ahure just overpowered a little bit in the end and got run out of it. She may well, let's see what sort of qualification she gets, because she gets third place. Yeah, and she's okay. Yes, she is okay. She's through to the final. 11.04. In fact, they both get through from that heat.
No,
I was just looking at Ahure and
11 seconds for Baptiste in the
previous one. Oh, yes, that's
one,
right. Yes,
and
yes,
then
indeed.
11.01 here.
Yep, yep.
Very, very good start, of course, Ahure and Madison, but so strong, Okagbare, in the finish there.
Couldn't believe how quickly she came through in the last 10 strides or so. She didn't look to be in it, and then all of a sudden she was there and powering through.
And Karen Stewart, we've been used to seeing, just misses out, used to seeing her in finals.
And next into the circle is Lee, who had a no throw in the first round. So this world champion in 2011 goes well over the 65 meter, and that red line as well you saw on your screen indicates who's leading, the distance that's leading, and the discus went way past that too. So this discus competition starting to heat up, and Lee from China gets hold of one after having missed and no throwed on her first attempt. That sails out into the air way past the 65 meter line. World champion in 2011, so she's hitting that sort of form. She was the third qualifier in the qualifying rounds with 64.48. So just wait, it 67.22. That's a great second round effort, and she goes into the lead.
Well, just about to start the men's long jump final as well. We saw them coming out into the field. Well, we don't have people of the caliber of Mike Powell, who set that wonderful world record in Tokyo in the greatest ever field event duel up against Carl Lewis, or indeed, of course, the Olympic record, which still stands to Bob Beamon. But it could be a fascinating event, because this is an event, one of the most open events of any in the championships here. Mitchell Watt of Australia there, perhaps the favourite coming in, but you can make a case out for quite a number of the men in this field. It's just a question of who's going to be good on the day. Sebastian Bayer of Germany, another man to look out for, produced a wonderful jump, 8.71, to win the European indoor title a year ago. A man who can produce the best when it really matters.
And they're just about to introduce them, so we have, and this is in the order that they will jump in the competition, so Sebastian Bayer from Germany, dubbed Germany's Bob Beamon. He's got an indoor PB of 8.71. Henry Frayne of Australia, the world indoor long jump silver medalist in 2012. We have Da Silva, Mauro Da Silva of Brazil, world indoor champion. Mitchell Watt of Australia. Greg Rutherford, who shares the British record with Chris Tomlinson, is also in this competition. He'll be introduced in a little while at 8.35. We have Will Clay from American, the 2012 world indoor champion at triple jump. So he's probably the best combination jumper of long and triple jump. We have Makina from South Africa, 2008 Olympic silver medalist from Beijing. Alexander Menkov from Russia. He won the bronze in the World Indoor Championships in 2012. Marquise Goodwin, 2011 US champion. Tomlinson from Britain, 30-year-old, 8.35 personal best. Michel Tonies from Sweden, Swedish record holder and five times champion. And then to conclude the list, Tyrone Smith from Bermuda. He's the 2011 Central American and Caribbean champion. And in the discus, we have Barrios coming into the circle for her second round throw. And she really is a bundle of power, isn't she? And she screams. I like the scream. That really does finish off the imagination in terms of the energy that she sort of gets generated as she turns in to let go. Every ounce of every piece of effort goes into that hand with the discus in, and she clenches her fist as she watches the discus go into the night air. It's just short of Lee's throw of 67-22. Great shots of that discus flying through the air and then breaking the ground. 66-38, so she goes into second place at this moment in time. Next up will be Perkovic of Croatia, 64-58 on her first throw. This discus competition is definitely starting to heat up. The youngest ever European champion in 2010, and she goes over that leading mark set earlier by Li of China. And that throw, it gets the white flag, it will take the lead. Fixed feet, big rotational torque from that right hip into the left foot block. And she shouts after the discus. That's a fantastic effort. She'll take the lead. We're just waiting for that distance to come up. She takes the lead in the second round of this discus competition.
Well, looking back on the 100 meters, there was Okagbari coming up to beat Madison. Okagbari running 10.92, same time for Madison, and Ahore goes through to the final by taking third place at 11.01. Stewart just missing out this time. So eight women will contest the final of the 100 meters later today. And these are the athletes who'll go.
Yes, indeed. Jetta, Fraser Price, Campbell Brown, Okabari, Madison Felix, Kellyanne Baptiste, and Muriel Ahure, the two fastest qualifiers, make up the eight-woman field. And what a race that should be. There's no outstanding favourite, I have to say. A few question marks.
Well, that's certainly something to look forward to. Meanwhile, the discus continues. The long jump's just started. Beyer opened with a fairly modest 7.87. Frayne's just followed, 7.85.
And next into the circle is Lee of China. She took the lead halfway through the second round, but then that she was usurped by Perkovic, the young Croatian, through 68-11, so she's in second place at this moment. So Lee, third round throw in this discus women's final. Well, it looked like it was gonna go, but the red flag goes up, so Lee gets a foul. It was less than her second round effort. So she'll comfortably make the final eight who go through to the final three throws. So she just foot fouled the front of the circle there. So in trying to generate more force, she just lost control at the front of the circle. 67-22 in that second round. So next in will be Barrios, the Cuban. She's thrown 66-38 and currently is in the bronze medal position. She has won three successive silver medals in Osaka, World Championships, Beijing, and then in Berlin in 2009. She certainly got a gold medal shout, but that's going to be slightly lower than her second round attempt of over 68 meters. And she just get the feeling that she just loses her balance away from her hand, and then just doesn't quite use all of that force she generates in the circle into the hand that's got the discus in. Yeah, she says, I must try and finish up. 64-84, 66-38, her best attempt in the second round.
Well, now we move on to the women's 400 meters, the semi-finals. And once again, there are the records. There are three heats in this semi-final round, with just the first two to go through, plus two fastest losers. To the final tomorrow. It's a good field, this one. And it introduces the American who must be the favourite. But there it is. Joan Kuhidi of Ireland. Arunga of Namibia. Richards Ross of the United States, Kushina of Russia, White of Jamaica, Ahuragu of Great Britain, Zakari of Kenya, and Martin of Canada. And this really is a very, very tough race indeed, with only the first two to go through. It's a very, very tough race. Well, there is Sanya Richards Ross, the world's most prolific sub-52nd 400-meter runner, 49.28 her best this season. She's coached by Clyde Hart, got a bronze medal last time. But from the inside, Joan Kuhidi of Ireland, 51.43 this season, was fourth in her heat, qualified as the fastest loser for this semi-final. Drawn in lane two. Just being introduced now late on to the crowd. These are nervous moments indeed. She's got the inside lane. At least she will have an opportunity to see everyone else. But certainly with Richards Ross, Ahuragu, Kushina and Rosemary White all in the same race with only two to go through by right. Well, that really is quite some competition. Now there is the Namibian, Herunga, the Namibian record holder, 51.24, that record. She was third in her heat. And now, Sanya Richards-Ross, a real talent. Bronze medalist last time, then won the World Championship in 2009. Didn't do so well last year. But Kushina, very, very experienced across all of the sprints. She was semi-finalist in the 200 metres last year in the World Championships, incidentally. There's the Jamaican, Rosemary White. She's got a best of 50.62. And then Christina Horagu, the defending champion. The reaction from this crowd is just immense, absolutely immense. What pressure indeed. And there is Zakari of Kenya. She was third in her heat, 51.85. Co-holder of the Kenyan record, just inside Jenna Martin, twice the Canadian champion, right on the outside with Richards Ross. Now Richards Ross learned how to run after 2004 when she went off far too quickly for the first 200 meters, and she's since learned the lesson. She is by far the quickest, and she's got Kushina, the Russian outsider, who's got a 49.28. In fact, they've got identical seasonal times, Richard Ross and Kushina, the Russian. It'd be very interesting to see how this comes out, because Richard Ross certainly is the favourite, but just the first two to go through. Well, I tell you what, Richard Ross went off like a rocket. Has closed down on Kushina already, right on the outside. Martin of Canada going very well. Ahuragu are running a very steady, better first 200 metres. She's being chased down by Rosemary White, though, as they approach 200 metres. Kushina going strongly. It's very even as they come through 200. The Canadian now has faltered, so has the Kenyan on the outside. And the big names coming into it. Rosemary White is there. Ahuragu is looking very, very good on the outside. That big raking stride. Sanya Richards-Ross, though, looking very strong in the middle. Kushina is way, way down on her. Look at this for Richards-Ross, and Ahuragu coming through to take second place at the moment. And she's going to qualify by right. So as the defending champion comes through, as Richards-Ross just slows down towards the finish. But 50.08. And I have to say that Kushina didn't perform there. But certainly Christina Ahuragu did. And I don't know how much effort Richards Ross was putting in the final stages, but when she sees that, if she sees a film of it, then she'll realise that Ahorogu is looking very, very tough. Really tough.
I think Richards Ross ran that first half very, very quickly indeed, 200, and was able to ease down a little in the straight. Very fine controlled run by Ahorogu. We've seen her go off too slowly before now, but this was a very nicely judged race. And as you said, Gushina, who only came fourth here, was way below her form in the Russian championships. But Richards Ross here, look how much ground Ahorogu makes up. But I think one can say that Richards Ross certainly wasn't running all out at this stage. And in third place there, Rosemary White of Jamaica, but quite a long way back and may not have run quick enough to advance to the final here. Nice run by Richards Ross. Did nothing wrong in maintaining her favourites chance, I think, or certainly one of the favourites here for this race.
Well, Ahorogu, a season's best of 50.22 behind 50.07, and that really augurs well.
So next into the circle will be Perkovic, who took the lead in the second round with 68 metres 11. And the youngest European champion in 2010 won it again this year in 2012 in Helsinki. Third round throw. Now that looked pretty good. Wow, just over her last round throw of 68 metres and probably getting very close to 69. Now, you look at this fixed feet, it just, all that energy from that drive of the hip into that left foot block goes into her hand, and she knows, you look at that discus, it's flat in the air, it's sky, it just goes high, hangs in the air and just keeps going. Watch this, fantastic rotation into the strike position. Fixed feet throwing at its best, I would suggest.
Yeah, I agree with you. She's unbeatable during the season in the Diamond League series. She's always, even if she's been led in the first round or so, she's always come through 69-11. Wow.
Well, new that's national record.
Sorry, Peter. You'd know about the records, but that's a metre improvement on that second round throw of 68-11. So she goes 69-11.
Meanwhile, Chris, there's been no particular excitement in the long jump. We haven't had 8-metre jumping. But here is Chris Tomlinson of Great Britain. Oh, we do have an 8-metre jump, though, now. Well, the standard may not be too high, but Tomlinson has moved into the lead, and it's the 10th of the 12 jumpers.
Well, you know, Tomlinson, over the years, he's been the bridesmaid. He's either, if he hasn't got to the final, he's come 13th. If he's got to the final, he's come 9th. First round jump in his home Olympics, and Frank Atto will be breathing a sigh of relief because Tomlinson has nailed the first round jump to go into the lead, 8.06.
Well, just looking at Richards Ross. Now we'll soon see the face is relaxed. And that was the final. We'll just bring you up to date with the result of that. Sonia Richards Ross, then 50.07. Christina Horogu, a season's best, 50.22. Rosemary White and Yulia Gushina, the two fastest losers at the moment.
Two more semi-finals to come in the 200 metres. And we're looking at Amantli Moncho. Well, she's had 5 first places and 3 second places in big events this season. That makes sure that she is one of the favourites. The world champion last year. This just shows you the current third and fourth place. I don't think those times are good enough, though. Here's the lineup: Grenot of Italy, Pompey of Guyana, George, Nigeria, Moncho, Botswana, McCrory, USA, Day, Jamaica, Cox, Great Britain, and Logvinenko of Ukraine. So here's the former Cuban, who was fourth in the Pan American Games 9 years ago, now competes for Italy, Lebenia Grenot. 50.30 her best, Italian record, but she was disappointing at the European Championships when she was sixth. Alianne Pompey won the Commonwealth title for Guyana 10 years ago this year in Manchester. Regina George, she ran well in the Heat, the Nigerian, who has a best of 51.11, based in the United States. And here's a Moncho who hasn't run a bad race for a long time now. The world champion, Commonwealth champion, 49.54, her best. May have lost in the London Grand Prix to Ahorogu, but she's in fine form. Then McCrory, who was third in the US Championships, fourth in the Worlds. Christine Day, third in the Jamaican Championships, newcomer in the Jamaican team this year. She's run 50.85. Shayna Cox, British parents, has enabled her to take up British citizenship. That roar from the crowd and plenty of support for an athlete with a best of 50.84. And the field completed by the Ukrainian champion, gold medalist in the relay in the Europeans, Alina Lokvinenko. The big favourites here, Moncho in five, and then McCorry outside her in lane six. Grenot, Pompey, George, Moncho, McCorry, Day, Cox and Lokvinenko. Starter not quite happy. Ask them to stand up again. So in lane five, Moncho, just going a little way down the track.
Just been called for a green card from the starter, which is a technical problem and nothing to do with the athletes. You just see it being waved there. Just to emphasize to all of the athletes that no one was responsible. It was a technical problem.
In semi-final two, the women's 400 meters. Looking at Moncho in five, and McCorry, who usually starts fast, the American, is doing just that. She's coming up on the Jamaican Day, but also Cox of Great Britain. The crowd are roaring. She's got off well, but it's the tall American, McCorry. Moncho, though, keeping well in touch in this race. Moncho, the favourite from Botswana, tracking the American McCorry all the way. It's those two with a pretty big lead now, with the Jamaican Day in third place behind them. Grenot running quite well on the inside as well. But the two favourites now sweeping into the home straight together. Grenot is in third place, but it's McCorry and Moncho. Pretty much side by side. Who's going to get the verdict? Could be important for lanes. Moncho just dips on the line and just takes it from McCorry, and they are really well clear of the rest of the field. So once again, just like we had in the first semi-final, two athletes really way out on their own there. McCorry ran hard all the way, but Moncho was obviously determined just to make sure she did get a good lane, and she's won this race in 50.15 and McCorry 50.19. Well, not quite such fireworks as we had in the heats, really. It's obviously getting cooler here. Grenot, though, a long way back in 51.18, and that is not going to be enough, I don't think, but nonetheless it is number four at the moment, or other the second best of the third and fourth places. But a good strong run here for McCorry, and Moncho doing just enough, Stuart.
Yes, she did. She looks very comfortable and easy into the straight. You can see the difference between the two. McCorry was running a little bit harder to achieve her position here. And it was very clever, Amantel Moncho, in the end. You just watch this little dip, just enough to get it. Look, the American looks as though she's going to get it, and then all of a sudden, little dip there. And that's makes the difference, and that's called experience, and that means that you'll get a better seeded lane, because here McCrory must have thought, well, that's it, I've got that, and then all of a sudden, look, that's it, that's the way you do it. Wonderful. And the rest way down. In the end it was quite substantial. All of a sudden there was a little surge at the end, wasn't there? Good run by Moncho. She's tough.
And into the circle for her fourth round throw. She's currently in fifth position, the world leader in 2012. Pishnalkova. And the scream deserves a long throw. And it's around the 66 meter mark, and that's, you can see it's got the bronze line there. So she's creeping towards the bronze medalist. Bronze medalist currently held by Barrios, the Cuban. She's in third place at the moment. Now, turns that fixed feet style of throwing again. Now, this was a lady, Pishkalnikova, that was banned a couple of years ago, early in her career, for a doping offence. But she's now back into the fold. And 66.42, that takes her up into the bronze medal position.
Another look at the final stage of that race between McCrory and Moncho. And Moncho, all of a sudden, a little surge. It was quite beautifully done, actually. The American almost eased off in the end, but really, you want to win your races if you can without exerting too much pressure and using too much energy. With the final tomorrow, got to reserve a bit, those legs will be tired.
So the result is semi-final two, Moncho 50.15, McCrory 50.19, advancing to tomorrow's final.
Greg Rutherford lining up for his second attempt in this long jump final for men. Well, it's a good jump. It's over 8 metres against the white flag. The crowd respond.
Well, that's the leading jump so far, and it's Britain 1-2.
So, perfectly on the board for Rutherford. And it goes over that line in the sand, which is indicating the leading mark so far. It's got good speed onto the board. 8.21 into a minus 0.6 win. So, at this phase in the competition, as we move into the second round, Rutherford takes the lead and Tomlinson moves back into second place. Very early stages, though.
Well, the final heat of the semi-final round of the women's 400, Lee McConnell drawn in lane two, Omotcho of Nigeria in three, Trotter of the United States in four, Clifford Shapka of Russia in five, Pigda of Ukraine in six, Williams Mills of Jamaica in seven, then Rodriguez of Puerto Rico in eight, and Welsh of Haiti run on the outside. Lee McConnell of Great Britain. That is a tight inside lane. At least you'll have the opportunity to see and to work off Omotcho of Nigeria, who's a 51.28 runner at her best, which qualified, as you see in the bottom left there, 52.11. Second in the Nigerian Championships. Didi Trotter, another of the Americans here. Fifth in Athens in 2004. Helsinki as well, the World Championships in five and seven. So she's had a few fifth places. Krivov Shapka is the fastest in the world this year with 59.16. This is Bigba of Ukraine. European indoor silver a couple of seasons ago. 51.09, a best set this season. Well, Novleen Williams-Mills of Jamaica, very accomplished Olympic semi-finalist, the last two Olympic Games. Well, this is Rodriguez of Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico record holder at 100, 200 and 400 metres. And then Wesh, the Haitian record holder at 200 and 400, and the hurdles, incidentally, drawn right on the outside. So, McConnell, Omotcho, Trotter, Krivoshapka, Shapka, Pigda, Williams-Mills, Rodriguez and Wesh. Fastest woman in the world. The ritual, the personal ritual. Just waiting to be called. Fashion at the fore. So, first two to go through. Didi Trotter in the fourth lane. Williams Mills will go off very, very quickly indeed, the Jamaican. We've seen that before. And the crowd respond to the bark of the gun now, and Williams Mills is really having to chase. Shapka's gone off like a bullet down the back straight, she really has, and Rodriguez of Puerto Rico going strongly, but look at this from Krivoshapka. She is absolutely flying. She's running this like a final, just as she did the first round. And at 200 metres, she's way ahead. But Williams-Mills will close her down a little bit, I fancy, in the final stages. And look at this for Dee Dee Trotter's got a lot to do, the American. And it depends how much the Russian's got down the straight. She's going to pay, and she is paying. She's now starting to tie up. And here comes Dee Dee Trotter. Kvyatshapka's going to tie up, or does she stay there? She just gets it from Dee Dee Trotter from Williams-Mills, and wow, she faltered 49.81. She ran that like a final, didn't she? That was a very, very quick first 200, and I have a feeling that if she does that in the final, she's going to get run down. There's no question about that.
Well, it was sub 23 seconds for the first 200 metres, just a little bit too quick.
Oh, very much so. I mean, she was absolutely flying, and she needs to learn from that, because she will be run down by a Horagu, she'll be run down by Richards Ross and the rest, really. But look how far she was ahead here, and look how far behind Dee Dee Trotter, the American, was.
But this much the fastest of the semis, the first three all breaking 50 seconds. So, of course, Williams-Mills in the yellow of Jamaica will make it through to the final, all right.
Yeah, she will, but they ran it like a final. Very different to the other races. This was very much a final, and she was absolutely falling apart towards the end. She did hang on a little bit, but Nobley and Williams-Mills ran a little bit more of a sensible race there, and she has been accused of going off too quickly herself. But the Russian was eyeballs out, there's no question about that. And the rest, look how they closed her down. Not quite enough to get there, but in the final, the others will have noted that.
Well, Williams-Mills making it, and the other one who's going to also make it the final is another Jamaican third placer. That's Rosemary White.
And back in the discus circle, we have Pishkalinkova coming in for her fifth round effort. She's improving, she's starting to get into this game, this discus competition tonight. She's taken three or four throws to really start to wind up, but this is her fifth round attempt. And she gets a great shout after she let go, and that takes her over that silver line, which is indicative of the current silver mark, which is held by Li of China. Again, great pictures of, well, the top half of her throwing body, the legs the most important bit, and then the arms just hang on. You've just got to set it all up to take advantage of the power and the thrust and the torque from the lower limbs. 67.56, she moves into silver medal position behind this lady, Sandra Perkovic, who leads with that 69.11 thrown in the third round. And in the long jump, we have Will Clay. He's sitting in third position with 7.98 in the first round. This is his second round attempt. And Clay encroaches into the pit around that line that Rutherford set with 8.21 earlier. Great placement of his takeoff foot on the board. He gets great extension off the board. That just leaves him plenty of space to get those legs through, to shoot those legs through together. And he's threatening the lead of Rutherford from Britain. Oh, well, 8.07.
That takes him a centimetre ahead of Tomlinson now, then into second place. Real speedster, isn't he? Really fast down the runway.
Fantastic speed on the runway. And then coming into the circle for her fifth round throw. The order's reversed after the first three rounds, and eighth goes first, and Perkovic, who led at that point, she goes last. Well, it's over 65 metres, but it's nowhere near the 69 meters 11 that she threw on her third round throw to take the lead in this competition. It was a period where the throwers were coming into the circle and putting them out over 65 meters, culminating in her third round effort at 69.11. That's not so good. She had a no throw in the fourth round, She shakes her head and pulls the funny face, which is what discus throwers do. The youngest European champion in 2010 ever in the women's discus. 66-96.
It's three throws at that or more. It's fine standard, isn't it?
The standard in the competition is actually very, very good. Discus standard has picked up over the last 3 or 4 years. So, into the circle. She came in eighth, but she's now moved up to sixth with that 68 throw that she had in the fifth round. So she's not galloping up the leaderboard, but she's certainly moving stealthily. Very fast in the circle. And that could be a slight improvement for the French girl, Robert Michon. Very fast across the circle. She uses this fixed feet style of throwing. And it does seem to be a common feature that the shout goes out when they think they've got a decent throw. It is a best effort, 63-98. But she stays in sixth position overall. Punia came into this competition in seventh, and she stayed in seventh, 63-62 in the fifth round. Sixth round throw. Seems to have a low hand position at delivery. Shrug of the shoulders, comes out the back of the circle, which makes that a white flag throw, as long as she's not encroached the front of the circle. But you can see that arm, that throwing arm, just comes in low, and that discus doesn't get any great height off the front foot as she drives it out into the night air. So Punia, 61-31. She'll finish in seventh position with a best throw of 63-62 in the fifth round. So, the reigning Olympic champion. She's going to break the sequence of gold medalists from Beijing winning if she doesn't win this tonight. But she struggled, but she qualified in her last throw this morning. So, or in the qualifying round. But I'm afraid the discus turned up like that just doesn't fly very well at all. So, her reign as the Olympic champion will be over. There will be a new crown on the head of a new winner in this women's discus this evening. And it's just over 60 meters, but it won't be going anywhere near the current leader's throw, Perkovic, who's thrown 69 meters 11. I think that's what you call getting up close. So we're just waiting for that distance to come up for Brown Trafton. But 61-89, 63-01 was her best, and she'll finish eighth in this competition in 2012. So into the circle. She came into the last eight holding fifth position. Pishkalnikova of Russia, last chance to get to that gold medal. She's in silver medal position. And she's missed that totally. So she won't be winning the gold medal tonight. She might take the silver, but clearly upset about that. She just totally missed it. Can't believe that everything seemed to stop. Let's just see what happened. She wasn't active into the center, and then the arm just took over the delivery, got ahead of the hips. So she'll be rueing that missed opportunity. She gets the white flag, and we're just waiting for the distance. 59-13, so 67-56 put her into that silver medal position. Now, will she hold on to it as we start to go into the higher ranked athletes after the first eight? The cut made after the first three rounds. The top eight take a further three throws. And we're now into the last round of those three throws.
Well, Moolah next has been very consistent. She's had four throws within a metre and a half, but she hasn't produced some magic yet, has she?
No, she hasn't. And she's the one of two girls that are 1 metre 93. Very tall German. Her best was the first round, 65-71. She's been consistent, but slightly at a lower level. She's very tall. And she goes over 65 metres, but short of the bronze medal line that we could see in the field there. And great position in the middle, but just seems to flex those knees a little bit as she starts to strike. Fixed feet, so she drives into that front foot at the front of the circle. And it will be her best throw. She started well and she's finished well, but it's not going to threaten the medalist. And she 65-94, and she finishes in fifth position. So next up is Barrios from Cuba. She is, or she was, in bronze medal position at the start of these last three throws. Pishkalinova Kanikova has taken the silver medal slot and pushed her out of the medal positions. Well, it's a gold medal shout, but it comes down at 65 metres. She knows it. She's going to finish in that place that no athlete really wants to finish, in fourth place. Once we get confirmation of the distance she's thrown, but it will be around 65 metres. Her best will be 66.38. And she threw that best throw, 66.38 in the second round. So she'll finish fourth. So the only person now who can take gold off Perkovic, the Croatian, will be Lee of China. She took an early lead in the second round at 67 meters 22, but really hasn't got too close to that. She's had a series of no throws. That was very close to the right-hand side of the cage, which indicates that it's gone. So Perkovic, she wants to get a good last throw. She's showing no emotions. Pishkalnikova takes the silver. Lee of China takes the bronze. Pressure got to her, went out the sector. She got a no throw on her last attempt. 67-22 takes the bronze medal. This young lady, Sandra Perkovic of Croatia. Now she shows some emotion and she wants the crowd to help her finish off this competition. Can she do what the Pole did in the shot last night? Finish with his best attempt on the last round when he knew he'd won the gold medal. He came into the circle and he threw it further than he had all competition. 69 meters 11. In the third round to take the lead, and she stayed in the lead since then. Perkovic from Croatia. Well, she seemed to top that a little bit, which means that she got her hands ahead of the hip strike. Now the emotion comes out. The Croatians in the crowd jump up and down. Customary to go over, run over, find your coach. Give them a bear hug in these cases of the throwers. They give these. There he is. And she's sobbing. And it's jubilation in the Croatian camp tonight. Perkovic, the youngest ever European champion in 2010, and then won again in Helsinki in 2012. And now she's the Olympic champion in London 2012.
And also the first Croatian athlete to win an Olympic gold medal. Vlasic had got a silver, and now Perkovic has got a gold. The first ever for Croatia.
Well, what a fantastic statistic. So they'll be drinking dry. The ale house is in that country tonight. 69 meters 11, Sandra Perkovic, women's discus champion. London 2012, gold medal hangs around the Croatian's neck tonight. Great scenes of celebration. I always wonder whether the heavy throwers will actually get round the track when they do their lap of honour.
Now come to the conclusion of the heptathlon, and there are the standings. Jessica Ennis surely on her way to a gold medal, but it's going to be mighty close for the other medals. If you just run down the standings of all those who are left in the competition. We have just one event to go, and it is the 800 metres. And that will take place in four races. And what we have is the last four in the standings who are still going in the first races, then the next three, then the next three, and finally the top nine athletes will take part in the final race. So the medals will be determined in the fourth of these races for the 800 meters. So these are very much the athletes at the foot of the standings. Hailes Fountain, who had so many problems, she was injured and she had a very, very modest javelin throw, is fortunately not starting. Louise Hazel has had an up and down competition, but was rewarded with a 47 meter 38 personal best in the javelin. Commonwealth champion going here in the eighth lane. 2:15, her 800 meters best. All the athletes in this race are best between 2:11 and 2:18. But as I say, these are well out of contention for medal placings. But it's a question of honour, and it's a question of how high up the competition they finish in the end. So we have Karpova of Kazakhstan, Markussen of Norway, Cowley of New Zealand, Mechtig of Germany, Dadic of Austria, Hazel of Britain, and McMillan from the USA. So I'm quite sure that Louise Hazel will get plenty of support from the crowd. I expect they've had it explained to them that these are really the athletes at the bottom end of the heptathlon standings. Heptathlon, of course, we started yesterday with the 100 meter hurdles. We went on to have the high jump and the shot in the field, and ending the first day with the 200 meters. And then today we've had three very different type of events. We've had the long jump, and then we had the javelin, and now we're finishing up here with the 800 meters. So the early leader in this race, Ida Markussen of Norway. Well, she's got a personal best of 2:11.01, so certainly would be the favorite for this particular race. Dadic of Austria is following her. Still a junior, the youngest in the field at 18 years of age. Markussen and Dadic coming up to the 400 meter point, going through that in 65.7. So that's pretty much on a par with their best performances. Commonwealth champion Hazel, if she could keep up the pace she's going at the moment, she could challenge her personal best of 2:15.36, and she's certainly getting support from the crowd, who are supporting her as she goes along. And just behind her, in fact, are the competitors in the long jump, where we've still got two British athletes in medal positions, I believe, John.
Yeah, Tomlinson's on the runway. You can see him in the background there. We'll get that played back perhaps in a bit.
Tomlinson lying third, Rutherford lead. We've seen all the leading jumps. Clay still in second place. But not a competition which is a very good standard. Only three men over 8 metres before Mitchell Watt of Australia, 7.97. Well, here's the battle in this race of the heptathlon. Just for minor positions, but they'll be keen to move up if they can. And here's Markussen of Norway. Well, she hasn't had a particularly good competition, but it's lovely to get the roars of the crowd in the Olympic Stadium and coming through to win a race. And she's won that in 2:13.63. Dadic is finishing in second place there. And just behind her, the rest of the field just beginning to come in. A couple of very tired athletes coming in way down the field, without perhaps, one could say, too much incentive to really go too hard. We've seen Karpova of Kazakhstan finish, and then the final athlete just crossing the line now That's McMillan, Chante McMillan of the United States. 2.13.62 for Markussen, 2.15.90 for Dadich. 912 points added to Markussen's total. Winning time there of 2.13.62. We could well get times inside 2.10 as we still have celebrations for the discus.
Yeah, Perkovic is still milking the crowd for as much as she possibly can. And I guess, as you suggested, the first ever major games winner from Croatia in track and field. And here we have the final standings. First, Croatian, Sandra Perkovic, 69 meters 11. Silver medal to Pish Kalnikova, 67.56. She was the world lead leading into this competition. And Yangfeng Li of China, 67.22. Stephanie Brown Trafton from the US of A, who was the champion and gold medalist in Beijing in 2008, came eighth.
Perkovic, of course, has won major titles in the Europeans, but first Olympic medal there. But here's a look back at the 400 meters. Here's Krivoshapka, who really went all out there, Stuart.
Yeah, indeed, she did. Krivoshapka just won it in 49.81, and I do mean won it. She was eyeballs out. Didi Trotter, 49.87, and Novalin Williams-Mills qualifies the fastest loser at 49.91. Well, there are the finalists. Krivoshapka, Trotter, Williams-Mills, Richards Ross, Moncho, McCrory, Ohorogu and White. And White, the other fastest qualifier there with 50.98. But it promises to be a really good final, that.
So here we have Goodwin of America, the US of A. 7 meters 80 on his second attempt. This is his third jump in this long jump final for men. Well, he's got good speed on the runway. He comfortably, or just on the board, doesn't seem to get a whole heap of lift off the board, but has great sort of horizontal speed. He could just do with stepping and getting those hips higher in the position. So 7.76, and he'll finish ninth, which means he won't make the cut in the long jump final because he's not in the top eight.
Well, there's the result of the first race of the heptathlon 800 meters. Markussen winning in 2.13.62. Of course, those are the athletes who are lying 28th and lower. So we look at the second list. Now, these are the athletes currently lying 19th to 27th overall. Looking at Maximova of Belarus. The reason we're looking at her is that she's got the best personal best of 2.11.29. She's second from the inside. There's Kurban of Russia, another useful 800 meter runner with 2.12.42. as her best. We're concentrating those two. I'm not quite sure they are necessarily that much of a standout, but if you've got to identify anyone, those are certainly two of the better 800 meter runners in this lineup of Farkas of Hungary, Maximova of Belarus, Sadeko of Estonia, Kurban of Russia, Sprunger of Switzerland, De Anicheto of France, Kluchinova of the Czech Republic, and Ifantidou of Greece. I think Sprunger could be a contender here. She's did a very good 200 meters yesterday, and she's also set a Swiss record at 300 meters recently. But this is the 19th to 27th places in the heptathlon, so we're just building towards the lead. We'll have two more races to come, and then we'll see, of course, the major contenders for a title, which looks to be almost certain for Jessica Ennis, but very, very close indeed for silver and bronze, between at least five athletes in contention for those places. So once again, the heptathlon, the one track event we're concentrating at the moment, with, of course, in the field, the long jump still going on. We've the halfway stage of that competition.
Yeah, the they're making the cut now and just refiguring the technology so that it reflects that there are eight jumpers now remaining in the competition for their final three jumps. And when you look at the field and you look at the lead being with Rutherford with 8 meters 21, and then just three other jumpers over 8 meters, and you look at the existing Bob Beamon record, Olympic record from 1968 of 8.90, you start to look at the fact that the level of competition here, and every competition is different, but it's certainly not the greatest long jump competition, but it's going to be very competitive in the last three rounds.
Well, certainly very close. The long jump standards way off what they were 20 years ago, but meanwhile, in this second race of the 800 meters, we have Maximova of Belarus, who's gone well clear of the rest of the field. It isn't, of course, about a victory, it's about how many points she can get. And now a burst through. Diana Chato of France has obviously felt she's got quite a lot left, and she's coming past the Hungarian Farkas and has got Maximova in her sights. And the way she's finishing, she could yet get her in the finishing straight here. No, perhaps not. It's a little bit too much of an ask, because Maximova is going on in good style here, the Belarusian who's going to come to take this second race in the heptathlon. Similar time to the first race, in fact, 2:13:37. And Diana Chato, well, she had a spirited burst, but she in the end just hang on for second place there. And some very tired athletes, obviously, after completing their seven events over the 2 days that we've had, first 2 days of London 2012.
Well, coming up shortly is the 10,000 metres final for men. And, of course, that's going to be a really big race here in the Olympic Stadium. Kenenisa Bekele on the right of that group of Ethiopian specialists. He's not been at his best right the way through this season, although he's a man who can perform. Mo Farah of Great Britain is a man in form at the moment. And, of course, did so well in the World Championships last year, and I just wonder whether he can repeat all of that here. It's going to be tough with the Kenyans and the Ethiopians with the full teams there behind them, and that may well prove to be one of the difficulties there. The Eritreans and other nations will have teams in this race. That's coming shortly.
And in the third round, he's currently in 10th position, Mikael Tornaeus. He's jumped 7 meters 80, so this is his third and final attempt to get in the top eight of this long jump competition. Oh wow, he's gone out close to that 8 meter mark on his third jump, so he's going to move up the leaderboard. He needs to, because he currently resides in 10th position. That's not a bad placement for his takeoff foot on the board. Great extension of the hips, so that means he's got good height, allows the legs to shoot forward. And 8.07, and he takes the bronze medal position off Tomlinson in that third round, so he will make the cut. A figure of concentration there from Rutherford, who perhaps he wouldn't be surprised that he's in the lead in this competition, 81, but at the start of the competition, he might have been surprised that actually 8.21 at this point in the competition would be in the lead. So we have De Silva of Brazil. The surprise new world indoor champion in 2012.
Well, he's a man who's inconsistent but can produce a big one, so he's going to be a danger right the way through. That wasn't it. That was a little bit further down, but he's a man that I think Rutherford might know could suddenly produce an 8.28.30.
Well, it was great placement on the board. He seems to over-rotate a little bit, so he didn't get full extension at the highest point as he got off the board, but he now goes over 8 metres, so he's starting to warm up a little bit. He's gone 8.01. And that's his best attempt so far in this competition.
heptathlon. We now come to the athletes lying from 10th. There we have, well, first of all, we have the result of the previous race. That was Maximova's win there. Well, here are the athletes then. These are, as I say, the athletes from 10th through to 17th. So Melnichenko, Johnson, Thompson, Issa, Day, Tyson, Broerson, Skippers, and Samuelson. So none of these are in a position to contest a medal, but of course they could move up. And here's Johnson Thompson of Great Britain, thrilled to be taking part as a youngster in the Olympic Games, the European junior champion at long jump, an outstanding multi-event prospect. Brilliant in the high jump yesterday at 189, matching her hurdles best as well. And I think has really enjoyed taking part in the Olympics. She is going to be someone to watch out for in future games. Melnichenko of Ukraine, then Johnson Thompson, then Issa, then Day, then Tyson, then Broerson, then Skippers, and then Samuelson. Now Samuelson on the Swede, right on the outside, very much the best 800 meter runner here. Best of 2:07.03. So Samuelson coming across the field to take the lead, making her way steadily across once they've broken from lanes. And really she's going to have to run a pretty much a solo race here, and she wants to move up into the standings, into the top 10 overall if she possibly can. Behind her we've got Tyson, the American collegiate champion, the Canadian, who's the fiancé of the great decathlon world record holder Ashton Eaton, who we look forward to seeing later in these games. Oh, but sadly Issa has had to call it a day. That's a shame. 400 meters, 61.85. That's pretty quick for Samuelson. And indeed, she's dragging through the rest of the field to some pretty useful times as well, I think. Looking there at 3.283, that's Sharon Day of the USA, who's in third place overall at the moment. Samuelson leading, Tyson in second place. Melnichenko in the Ukrainian colors of blue and yellow. That's Melnichenko there moving away from Day. Third and fourth places, but way up front, Samuelson has led from the off here. The roar in the stadium is not for these runners, it's for Tomlinson on the long jump. Could be something special, we'll look at that soon. Then we have now Samuelson coming in to win this second race in the 800 meters, and a really good performance here. And Johnson Thompson, the youngster, the crowd roar her on, she's come through to take second. 2:09.29 for the winner there, and Johnson Thompson has smashed her personal best, 2:14.56, and she must have run about 2:11 there. So what a start to a senior international competition young Johnson Thompson from Liverpool has had here.
And in the long jump, we have Sebastian Bayer from Germany, who has made the cut and now comes in for his fourth round jump. Wow, he gets good height. Nice rhythm on the runway. And Bayer just gets a clean, just a centimeter between the toe of his spikes and the plasticine, and that's his best jump tonight without any doubt whatsoever. And this long jump, 8.10 meters, he goes into second place with that fourth round jump. Tomlinson coming up for his fourth round attempt. This long jump starting to heat up, and he goes long too. Now second place has just gone to Bayer with 8.10 meters. Is he now back into the medal positions? That's fantastic placement on the run-up. He does look very quick. He gets a massive strike off his takeoff foot. Great height, good leg shoot. Sailing out into the pit. And Tomlinson, 8.07. Now, because he's had 8.06 on countback, He's now moved into the bronze medal position again, the position he had before the start of the third round of the long jump.
The final race of the heptathlon, it's the 800 meters, and we have the top nine competitors here. Jessica Ennis leading by the very big margin over Skoyte of Lithuania. Almost certain, unless something drastically wrong were to happen, that Ennis will take the gold medal. But Skoyte is not such a good 800 meter runner, and there are athletes behind her. Josipenko in third, Jimmu in fourth, Schwarzkopf in fifth, and Chernova in sixth, who could all, in fact, pass Skoyte. There's going to be some calculations about the margins that need to be done here. Ignanietsi of Latvia is on the inside. She's a little bit out of contention for the medals at the moment. Skoyte will be next to her. Now, Skoyte's got a best of just outside 2:15 for 800 meters. Now, Josipenko would need to beat Skoyte by some 6 seconds to overtake her. And that's within her compass, but that'll be close. So we'll have to keep a very close eye on the times that they all do. Here is Skoyte. Brilliant, of course, in the high jump and the shot put on the first day. She lies second at 5.783 points behind Ennis's lead of 5.971. Then we have Chernova. Now, she's one, perhaps the best 800 meter in the field. So although she's back in sixth at 5.657 points, she could move up and even overtake Skoyte, but she'd need to beat her by quite a big margin, by 12 seconds. Here is Jessica Ennis on her way to a gold medal. She needs to run about 2:12 to get the British record, and that's highly likely. Schwarzkopf is a good 800 meter runner. She too is certainly in contention for a medal, because she's only 9 points behind Josipenko, and that's fractions of a second. Then Savitskaya of Russia, the Russian champion this year, going in lane six. Josipenko is in third place, but she's got Jimmu and Schwarzkopf within 9 points of her, just behind. She's got to beat them, or at least be very, very close to them. Zelinka of Canada, a little bit out of contention there. And the field will be completed by an athlete who did brilliantly in the javelin today, Nana Jimmu Ida of France. So, as I said, Ennis is almost certain to get gold, provided she finishes the race in a reasonable time, but very much in contention, silver and bronze medalists. And we need to keep a very careful eye out for the positions, or more particularly, for the times. Jessica Ennis needing 2:12 for the record. That's the British or Commonwealth record. So off we go in the final event of the heptathlon.
Well, there are two laps of the track to go, and this is the equivalent for the women of the 1500 meters in the decathlon. And Jessica Ennis is a 2:07 800 meter runner at her best, and she's right out there at the moment on way to a gold medal. She's a clear favorite. She's had a marvelous heptathlon, followed by the tall figure of Chernova, and there is Skoyte, who they've all performed well, but Jessica Ennis making no mistakes at all here. It doesn't matter, it's not about winning this race for those newcomers to the heptathlon. What it is about getting a time inside 2:12. She's not going to lose the gold medal here unless, of course, she breaks down with injury, but that is unlikely to happen now. It's a very good first 400 meters for her, certainly, as they go through the 400 meters. Schwartoff of Germany, 61.89 for 400 meters. And Jessica Ennis now just holding her form now with less than 400 meters to go to gold.
And Chernova and Schwarzkopf in second and third, very much in contention for medals. They need a good time. Schwarzkopf could move up from fifth to take a medal. She's passing Ennis now. Chernova is now in third place. Skoyte is way out the back, and although she comes here in second place, I think she's going to end up outside the medals if she's not careful. Josipenko in third coming here is also in contention. But Chernova is very strong indeed at this event. Schwarzkopf is very strong indeed. Those are in contention, but look at Ennis's speed. She's holding her place there in third at the moment as the top four. Scooter knows that she's going to lose contention for medal. I think that's her chance gone. She's too far behind. Here's Chernova, but Ennis coming through for glory. A gold medal for Great Britain, a gold medal for Jessica Ennis coming through to win the final event, the 800 metres. It's going to be so close behind her. 2.865, magnificent performance. Chernova is in third place, and she's in contention for medal. Scooter is just coming through now. She's going to be too far back here. She's out of contention. Scooter, I'm afraid, has lost the silver medal that she was in contention for. But Ennis, a score of over 6,950 points. She's got the gold. She's been touted for that for so long. It's now happened as she collapses in tears. But she's smashed the British and Commonwealth record and becomes Britain's third women's multi-event Olympic champion, following in the footsteps of Mary Peters and Denise Lewis. The poster girl for these games, Jessica Ennis, has won the gold medal. So much pressure on her, and she has delivered.
It was a most wonderful, wonderful 2 days of competition. She cannot believe what she's achieved. She came here as the favourite, but it's not always a happy ending for favourites, but the British support here, very much supportive over these 2 days. It's been absolutely brilliant. There's the flag, the Union flag, and really, athlete Mr. Minicello will be absolutely delighted with that performance, as will the whole of Great Britain, as the rest of the camaraderie that ensues at the end of a multi disciplined event such as this.
And unofficially, I've got Schwarzkopf and Chernova in the other medal positions, coming all the way up from fifth and sixth in that final event which determined the medals. There's Schwarzkopf. I'm pretty sure that she's done enough to take the silver medal, but way, way out in the lead was Jessica Ennis. An absolutely magnificent performance, 6,955 points. And she's won by over 300 points, a massive margin.
And over the long jump from Sweden, we have Michael Tornias, who went 8.07 to get him into the top eight. And this is his fourth round jump. That was good speed onto the board. He hops out of the pit, he gets the white flag. And the Swedish athlete was fantastically on the board with his left foot. Just seemed to twist in the air as he took off. Lost a little bit of his momentum. But that looks like it could be 8.11 meters. So he moves into the silver medal position. Next up is Will Clay from America. 8.07 in the second round, his best attempt so far. That's the hang technique, and that looks a little bit better than his earlier attempt in the second round of 8.07. He puts his hands together, he's just waiting for the result to come up. Great on the board. Good speed into the takeoff zone. Great hip extension off the board to the high point. 8.12 meters, he takes the silver medal position behind Rutherford, who leads the competition currently. Rutherford coming up. He's the last to go in these last eight athletes in the final three jumps. He leads with 8.21. Great speed, ferocious attack. Just needs probably a bit more height and he could go even further.
I tell you what, he was going so quickly to hit that board, it was flat. He just converted that horizontal speed. Look at that lovely little situation in the air, and that's a good leg shoot. That looks better.
And shoots his leg out into Sam's arms raised. 8:31. He substantiates his lead at the top of the leaderboard. He was 8:21. He was winning comfortably so far. And now he goes to 8:31 to extend his lead. Rutherford in the gold medal position after the fourth round.
Here again is Jessica Ennis coming through to complete a magnificent 2 days of competition. Starting off, of course, with that British record in the hurdles. Personal best in the 200 metres, 22.83. Personal best in the javelin. And a fine win in this final event here in 208.65. 6.955 points and a huge winning margin, with Schwarzkopf coming through and Chernova as well to take the other medals in this competition. And all the heptathletes gathering, as is traditional for a multi-eventer. Great support from all of them. Well, what a story this is, because she's been featured in countless magazines, countless newspapers, posters all over the place as the big star of these games for athletics. And she's justified all of that.
Yep, she's a true athlete and a superb young woman, both on and off the track. And I think that's important. And her career is set now for the future on the basis of an unbelievable 2 days of Olympic gold medal winning form.
This performance takes her to fifth on the world all-time list for multi-events, and the next target for her will be 7,000 points, and who can doubt that she can get that in the years to follow. It hurt, of course it did, but what ecstasy as well.
The sheer utter relief of winning. It's over. I can't believe it. I'm the Olympic champion. The words ring in my ears, she says. Now, what thoughts? What thoughts? How fitting it is that she should do this in front of a huge crowd, 60,000 plus, 80,000 if you take all of the journalistic seats into account.
Now we go into the long jump. Mitchell Watt from Australia. He's currently in seventh position, coming up for his fifth attempt. Well, he just seemed to continue into the pit. He's gone over that silver line that's just graphically shown across the pit. He exhales, puffs his cheek out, just on the board, just short of the plasticine. Just seems to lean into the takeoff area, but gets great height, great extension, and then a fantastic leg shoot. So Mitchell Watt of Australia, 8:13, he moves into the silver medal position in the fifth round.
Well, it's only fitting they've entertained for 2 days that they should have the luxury of a full lap of the track to be greeted by this wonderful crowd here in the Olympic Stadium in London. A British girl, a British young woman winning gold. Wonderful. Good luck, Jessica Ennis. It's your big day. Well, it certainly is, and it certainly was. Marvellous moments. But I don't have to tell you what will be on the front pages of the British press tomorrow. Well, there is the result of that.
Yes, but a major shock there. Lily Schwarzkopf disqualified. Now, she finished in what would have been the silver medal. And if she's disqualified from that race, a medal has gone. So that's terrible.
Well, it might be, but there might be a protest. You never know.
Sure.
But at the moment, that is the situation.
Well, that would be a terrible way for the German athlete to end there. Well, there is the result. Now, I have Schwarzkopf at 6.649 points, if that 800 metres stood. But for now, at least, Ennis has got the goal, we know that. Chernova's got a medal, and Yosipenko up to the bronze if we take out Schwarzkopf from the standings. Well, one can only assume that's breaking from lanes too early.
Yeah, that's the only thing it could have been. I mean, it's Just trying to think of anything else, but I don't think so.
Shrotskov there, 5.692, no points for the 800. Well, I'm sure you're right, Stuart. I'm sure there'll be a protest about that. And she's been doing a lap of honour, looking very happy. Well, as soon as she's seen that, happiness will turn to bitter despair.
Well, it certainly will, and that is a sad ending for her, if that is verified. But now we come to a track final that has been much anticipated over the summer, and it's the 10,000 metres, and it has a field of, well,
29.
Everyone who 29. Is anyone in this field. 29 competitors, and Mo Farah of Great Britain really in very, very fine form. Now, I just wonder whether he will prevail here tonight, or will Kenenisa Bekele come back to the form and defend his title? Will Gebre Mariam, the other Ethiopian, prevail? There are so many ingredients in here. Tariku Bekele is there. And of course, Gadon Rupp of the United States, who's the training partner of Mo Farah. Well, the 100 metres for women will be coming up after the 10,000 metres, but at the warm-up track, the principals will be gathering their strength and making their final preparations before they go into that arena. Alison Felix, well, it might not be her day today. She needs to get the really quick start, and she is more of a 200 and 400 specialist, I have to say, but Carmeleta Jetta at 10.83 will certainly be one of the ingredients in the final reckoning, I fancy. But also Fraser Price, Shelly Ann, the defending champion, qualified with 10.85, looked very, very easy in that qualification. She'll be there or thereabouts defending her title. And of course, Veronica Campbell-Brown, and twice Olympic champion at 200 meters, had more success there. Well, that's just to whet your appetite as we go into the men's 10,000 metres.
A field of 29 athletes take to the track. It's a big field. It's a mighty strong one. We had a wonderful women's 10,000 metres. I wonder whether the men's will follow the same pattern. We have a huge contingent of East African talent. The great Kenenisa Bekele has had a time out from injury, but with every race this year, he's been getting better. He holds the Olympic record when he won in Beijing, just outside 27 minutes. He's here again. He's got his younger brother Tariku here as well. Let's have a look down that full list of runners on that first page. Athletes to look out for. We've got Zersane Tadisi of Eritrea. He was third and fifth in previous Olympic finals. We've got Gebre Mariam, former world cross-country champion. Tariku Bekele, Mo Farah, European champion 2 years ago, the British athlete who's highly favoured here to win both the 5 and the 10. We've got good Americans there in Tegenkamp and Ritzenhain, and Galen Rupp there at the head of that field. Kenenisa Bekele, one of the greatest athletes of all time, the Ethiopian, bidding for yet another major title. And the Kenyans are strong, with Wilson Kiprop and Moses Masai. And also young Karoki as well in the lineup. Fastest time in the world this year. That's Kiprop's time in Eugene. 27 minutes, 1.98. It's this big field take with two rows of athletes. Looking here at Ayeku of Uganda, the back view, 3110. Next to him, whole series of athletes in the back views there. Mucci of Italy right on the outside, the European bronze and silver medalist. Galen Rupp coming across there, the American, who now trains with Farah under the coaching of Alberto Salazar in Oregon in the USA. He's a mightily improved runner as well. Got the double Commonwealth champion, Kipsiro of Uganda. There's Kiprop, the top Kenyan runner this year. Next to him, we have the great Kenenisa Bekele, the man who succeeded Haile Gebrselassie as the world's greatest distance runner. Bekele, four times world champion at 10,000 meters. Twice the Olympic champion. Can he go into the history books with a third win. Moses Masai, the Kenyan, second in their, effectively their trials in Eugene. Ayeko of Uganda, Rupp of the USA. Ned Hin of Eritrea, strong East African contingent, of course. As we look back on the next group, there's a Rwandan, Kajuga, Ritzenhain, Levins, the NCAA champion from Canada, Sato, Tegenkamp of the USA, and there's Mo Farah. Look at them, listen to the roar. The crowd have already had a British gold medalist today. Can they get another? The younger brother, Tirico Bekele. Next to him, the Commonwealth double champion. As you can see him on the right of the screen there. Moses Kipsiro. There's Gebre Mariam, former world cross-country champion. Fourth in the Olympic 5000 last time. Kipsiro there, next to Piedra of Ecuador. National champion at a whole range of distances. Gebre Mariam, fifth fastest in the world this year. Strong Ethiopian trio, of course, with the Bekeles and Gebre Mariam. Took a lot to make the Ethiopian team. The world champion didn't make it. Tadesi of Ethiopia hasn't run a 10 this year, but always a man to look out for. Great record over the roads and the track. Al-Utabi of Saudi Arabia, Labovsky of Ukraine, Muchiri Karuki, the third of the Kenyans that we've seen now in this lineup. Ben St. Lawrence of Australia and Mahbub of Bahrain and Tess Faldet of Eritrea completing this lineup. A race to savor. 29 men at the start of the men's 10,000 meters. Some noise in the stadium with a long jump coming into the final rounds as well. O'Farrah looking happy. A great deal resting on his shoulders, but he's been in wonderful form over the last 2 years. The 10,000 meters.
Starter's marksman not happy. Someone's foot must have been on the line. Well, there's only 25 laps to go. But then... Bekele, a little smile, a nervous smile. What sort of form's he in? We don't know yet. But as this race gets underway, let me just report to you that, remember great names in the past. Paavo Nurmi of Finland in Antwerp in 1920. Emil Zatopek won this in London in 1948. He won it again in 1952 in Helsinki. And then, of course, 72 and 76, Lasse Viren won twice. And then Haile Gebrselassie in 96 in Atlanta and 2000 in Sydney. Haile Gebrselassie, the great Ethiopian, won that race. And then the man who we've already seen here, out in the front here for a change, Kenenisa Bekele of Ethiopia, won it in Athens in 2004 and again 4 years ago. So he's going for a third consecutive one, but I've not seen Bekele take the lead this season at all. And Mo Farah knows the danger and goes along with him. He certainly does.
Well, one was wondering what sort of tactics there might be in this race. And Kenenisa Bekele straight into the lead, followed by Farah and then Medin. And let's see what the pace is. Pretty good, 65 and a half second first lap. So they'll obviously take a lap or two to settle down, but we'll finish off the long jump.
Sixth and final jump for Mitchell Watt from Australia. He's in the silver medal position. Can he get towards Rutherford by even getting closer with this jump? It's great height. Again, he's getting over his own silver line mark. That's the graphic on the sandpit. He gets the white flag, but he may rue the day because he only got going really in that fifth round where he went 8:13. Very good on the board. Great height off the board. Didn't possibly get as much leg extension as he would have liked at the height of that parabola in the jump. Just waiting for the score to come up and the distance to come on the board. He increases his position in silver, 8 meters 16.
Torneos there, who of course is the best of 8:11.
Swede, who currently is in fourth position. Watt going back to Watt. That was 8.16. That put him securely into the silver medal position. And Tornes goes 7.98. We're just waiting to confirm that. 7.98. So he stays in fourth position.
Well, the last jumps to come up, but it's still Bekele coming up now to the kilometer point. 2:54.88. So after the first lap, the pace slowed a bit.
Yeah.
So we could just run down the list of athletes following him.
The last lap, 73.2. But the Bekele brothers sitting in their Kiprops there. Kajauga is there. Sato is there. Masai, everyone, because it has slowed down significantly.
And Will Clay is the only man who can take Greg Rutherford off the top of this long jump list. He currently holds the bronze medal position with that 8m12. He's 4 centimeters behind Mitchell Watt of Australia. Well, he loses control. So Rutherford raises his hands with the finger pointing upward. He doesn't have to take his sixth round jump. He is the Olympic champion in the men's long jump. What a great result for the young Briton.
Well, what a good evening for Britain so far, with two gold medals in the heptathlon and now in the long jump, and with Mo Farah in the 10,000 metres. This could be one of the great nights for British athletics, certainly. But there are an awful lot of talent there, but it has slowed down. And, you know, if it does slow down, then Mo Farah's got all the kit for fast finishing. He can run it from however he wants. And he's in the middle of that pack now. He's dropped right back. Kenenisa Bekele now in about fifth place. And that's Kiprop leading at the moment. And very happy to do so. And no one is prepared to push this along yet.
And Greg Rutherford now can enjoy that position of being top of the pile in the men's long jump. It's a little bit of a surprise. Both the Britons were fancied to do well in this competition. But to come out with the gold medal before you take your sixth jump, what a position to be in. He can just go for it. And it doesn't really matter. He's now going to salute the crowd. Milk it for whatever it's worth. Puffs his cheek out.
He is a really nice young man. He's a pleasant young man, and he truly deserves this. He's had his injury problems. He's had all sorts of problems. He's come back this season, and I've never seen him as consistent as he was this season. And really, whilst the long jump competitions in general have been at low ebb, you can only compete against what is here.
Absolutely. And if we did a statistical analysis with his personal best of 8.35 this year and jumping 8.31 tonight, he'd be the closest to his personal best without any doubt. All the other jumpers jumping below form. But Rutherford has nailed it tonight. He has won the long jump gold medal, London 2012. We'll see the graphic with the final results. He's got the photographers around him. He's holding up the British flag. And as Stuart and Peter have said, two gold medals in the stadium tonight for Great Britain. And with Mo Farah running in the 10,000, could it be three? So there you go, Greg Rutherford, winner, men's long jump, 8m31. Going to find his coach.
Coming up to 20 laps to go, and Tedessa and Maidin, the Eritreans, have gone to the front and they said, come on, let's have a race here. Bekele's there, Kiprop is in third, Bekele's in fourth, and really it's now starting to wind up, and it's all down to the former World Cross Country champion. I watched him in Mombasa win the World Cross Country title in the heat of that country, and look at this, it's opened out, and all of a sudden there are four moving away. And There is a gap, but it's very, very early days. We've got about 19 and a half laps to go.
Well, Sedis has often done this in major races, taken on the race. A very, very slow opener, 2:54.88 the first kilometre, and then 3:04.68 second kilometre, only just inside 6 minutes. But losing a shoe there, stopping to put it on, that's Moses Kipsiro of Uganda. Well, he's got time to catch up, but he's right at the back of the field.
Yeah, he is. I watched him win two titles in the Commonwealth Games. He had scintillating speed, he really did, in the final stages. There's his trip, actually. He's gone down, and that's unfortunate for him, but he'll have to come back. He's experienced enough to come back very, very slowly. But the Eritrean leads, and Mo Farah's back in about 12th place, but this is early days indeed, with 18 laps to go.
The 61.95 lap there, it was 69 before, and then before then we had 75 second laps.
Yes, indeed, it's that's rhythm sapping, that hurts. Once you start putting that sort of pace in, if it's sustained, and that's Murci of Italy moving alongside Mo Farah there down that back straight.
Well, Farah's playing very sensibly. He's not gone with this lead. He's just gradually, I expect, trying to pick his way up, as indeed is the case for some of the other big names in this race. But Tadisi is not to be underestimated. Well, 2:42.8 there, that third kilometre, after a 3:04. That's a very, very big change. As we run down that distance behind, the Farah there, 1:09 behind the leaders. Ritsenhein, Masai, the Kenyan, further back still in 14th place. And he's amongst the fancied runners. But we've got two Ethiopians here, third and fifth in this lineup. The other one, Gebre Mariam, very much towards the back of the field with only five men behind him.
Well, Wilson Kiprop, it's the fastest time in the world this year. He's now being overtaken. Bekele is really latching on. Oh, and we've got one withdrawal, and that is Mahboub of Bahrain. He's gone. So often happens. Al-Tabi in that shot there. He's in about eighth place, ninth place. And Mo Farah still in a very good position to attack here. I think he's alongside Rupp, isn't he? His training partner at the moment.
There they are. Americans together there. We've got also there the other two Americans being Tegan Camp and Ritsenhein, of course, in this race. But interesting how the two Bekele brothers are making a very prominent part in this race. Tadise, the Eritrean, leading out, but then the Bekele brothers behind them. And this is the rest of the pack, the Kenyans biding their time, the three of them pretty much together around the 10th to 12th places.
Well, they've done an awful lot of work, the two Eritreans. Tadese, the leading of the two, Medine. Well, he's was 32nd in the Olympics last time, 4 years ago, so hoping to do a bit better than that this time. 12th in the World Championships when they were held in Berlin. Mo Farah looks to me as though he's starting to make a little bit of a play now and move slowly but surely up the field. But he has got a terrific sprint finish in the end, but so has Bekele, but we don't know what sort of form Bekele's in. On the evidence of the season, we're not sure.
Well, it's not what he's done before, but the evidence also shows that he's been getting better every race, racing himself into form. The moment, the younger brother, Tariku, is in second place. Kenanisa is fourth. But look at the way the Kenyans are coming up. So Farah, they've been running a more even pace. Kipsiro, having fallen and put his shoe back on, is there just ahead of Rupp and Farah. So three of the big names there.
Al-Tabi of Saudi Arabia is also there in, fourth or sixth place at the moment. And the race beginning to evolve now quite nicely.
11:23.16, the time there at the 4 kilometre point.
Yeah, last lap 64.3 on the official computer.
This, it did get to a quick one of 61.9, but they're running it more steadily and gradually catching up on the leaders. Masai just ahead of Farah and Kiprop. And those are, well, Kiprop and Masai, the two fastest in the world this year.
Yeah, Masai close fourth last time, 4 years ago, wasn't he, in that 10,000 metre final. So he's got a sister who's quite good too, Lynette Masai, who's made some championship wins in the past. And Mo Farah just sitting back. I mentioned him several times, not because he's British, but because of what he's achieved this season thus far and the way in which he races. And I honestly believe that he could well have the pace. And the rest know this. They know him, and they know him well, which they didn't do in the World Championships last year. They didn't really know him. And he took a lot of people by surprise.
Looking here at Mucci, together with Kiprop, the Italian. Also haven't mentioned, he's a very prominent Alu Tabi of Saudi Arabia in the white vest there on the inside. But the field just beginning to collect together again, or a large proportion of the field so doing. But today, see, we've seen him so often, very determined front runner. He's often just missed out on the top medals, but he's very consistent. He's particularly good at the half marathon as well, of course.
Well, we're coming up to 13 laps to go in this 10,000 metre final, and it really is beginning to wind up quite nicely now. It's anybody's race, really. Tedesi has done the former World Cross Country Championship, as I said. He was the bronze medalist in 2004 in Athens over 10,000. So he's got the experience, but he does so often lead. But he's now had that lead taken away from him. And I tell you, the pace is generally hotting up. It really is.
Well, they're coming up to the halfway point now as the they come up to 200 metres on the other side of the track. It'll be outside 14 minutes, but we can expect it very, very much quicker in the second half. Let's just take a check of that 5 kilometres time. 14 minutes, 5.79.
Yeah, so it's definitely going to be a quicker second half. It certainly is. Just looking at the...
This is Muchiri Karoki of Kenya, the probably the third of the Kenyans who's decided to take it up from Tadisi, from Tariku Bekele. Then we've got Tesfalde, another Eritrean, coming up.
And here comes Mo Farah alongside to take close order at the front. And that's very sensible, just staying wide out of the trouble. But the two Eritreans back in business again. But I think they're playing in the hands of Farah, I really do.
The other Kenyans at the moment, both Kiprop and Masai, hanging back at the moment. They're some way down from the lead. We're just taking a look at them, in fact, there. Masai wears 2311 and Kiprop 2301.
That's Kiprop, the leading of the two Kenyans there.
Farah staying wide.
No, Farah getting into position.
Juga of Rwanda also there, and the another East African, of course. Tedesi pushing on again. He's determined. He's a really tough customer, Tedesi. Hasn't run a track 10,000. Tariku Bekele, the man who's following him, Kenenisa, just looking around, just behind Farah at the moment then. They're moving past. They're all just looking, just jockeying for position at the moment, making sure they're in a good place for whenever the real burst comes. Tedesi tested them out there. You see it slowed 67.5. having had a sub-62 lap early on.
Yes, they certainly left it down to what was virtually a 5,000-metre race here. And with 1,500-metre qualities for some of these athletes, certainly we know one or two of them can sprint at the end, can run, but whether that speed's run out of them, a little nudge there. Mo Farah complaining about
Medin.
Medin, who is just leaning on him a little bit there. Medin really pushing on Farah. He's saying, there's space there, I want to come in. There's a real battle going on between the two of them. Just off your shot.
Meanwhile, surge from Masai coming up now. The Kenyans are really running as a team, I think, here. And Muchiri has had his time in the leading Kenyan, and now Masai's coming up. I think interesting tactics. Ethiopians prominent, Kenyans prominent, and the three Eritreans very prominent.
Well, Farah's dropped back about five or six places to get himself out of trouble and trying to wind out wide. But Eritrea 1 and 2, Kenya 3, Ethiopia 4. And I tell you what, it's beginning to hot up a little bit now.
Yeah, well, it was a 2:46 kilometre there, so they're just jockeying positions, not as quick as earlier in the race. There's a lot of moving back and forth, particularly now by the Kenyans. And look at the way the Kenyans have moved up into the lead now. This could be significant.
Well, they're certainly going to have a go, aren't they? And
this is Kiprop.
Yes, Kiprop's taking it on.
Fascinating race, but there's still a lot of people
in fact, it's Masai. Sorry to interrupt you there, but it's Masai that's taken it on.
Yeah,
he's the
Kiprop
leading,
and
Kiprop and which here is the second of the
right.
Kenyans.
Kiprop we just saw on the screen, but it is the other two Kenyans working together, I suggest. Kiprop at the moment, though, is happy to stay back alongside Farah. Very much those two together.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it, that Kenenisa Bekele now has moved up. Remember, he's won this title twice, and he's really starting to wind it up. But I tell you what, it's Tarik Bekele who's moved up into third place to take close order.
But a dropout there in this race of attrition. We're gradually losing athletes one by one.
That wasn't Kiprop, was it?
It was Kiprop. It was Kiprop indeed. So that's a major shock. Kiprop out 18 and a bit minutes into the race. Well, I thought he was just biding his time, but it seems it wasn't right for him today.
Mukchiri leads, Masai in second, Bekele third. Then in fourth place is Arikan of Turkey. We haven't mentioned him too much. Former Kenyan, of course. And if Mo Farah is going to get involved here, he needs to take closer order, I think, with just eight laps to go. Still lots of time as Ahmed lose contact on the back of that group.
Well, the whole group now, what, some 25 metres from the first to the end of that group. And Masai and Karuki, or Mukchiri Karuki, as he's known here at the front.
Farah now moving through the field, up onto the shoulder of the two Eritreans now, the Kenyans one and two. Kenenisa Bekele is in fifth place at the moment, and Mo Farah now moving up into eighth position as they come into the straight, and it'll show there are seven laps to go.
Fastest kilometre of the race there, a 2:40, taking them up to 7k in 1932.58. Farah looking good, he's coming up on the Bekeles. Galen Rupp also is training companion, the American there, in fourth place. So Masai leads with seven laps to go from Karoki Mukchiri in second place. The Bekeles are third and fifth with Rupp between them. Farah is in sixth place.
Certainly the younger of the Bekeles, Tariku, world indoor champion at 3000 a few years ago, but he's come on since then, hasn't he? 27.03 is best time, but this is about championship running, and it's all change.
Kenya, Ethiopia, USA, Ethiopia, Britain, Ethiopia. Or rather Eritrea, the two Eritreans, Medin and Tadisi, just losing a bit of ground maybe now, having been prominent early on. Tadisi back in seventh place.
Well, it's a very good performance thus far by Rupp, certainly. And, you know, when you look at Alberto Salazar's stable, well, they're all up there in the first half a dozen, both of them. Mo Farah the second, but Rupp's having a race of his life at the moment. But then at this pace, one would expect him to be there. And I still think that they've got to watch out for the Farah finish. He's just ahead now of the second of the Ethiopians, that Medin. As we look.
Looking there at Cameron Livins, the NCAA champion, the Canadian, just tucked in there.
Yeah, and Gebre Miriam as well in at that point.
Well, the Kenyans are working together. Mukchiri looking around, saying to Masai, hey, it's your turn now. But of course, one of the great shocks is that Kiprop's not there with them. So now Masai's turn to take it on. Yeah. And Farah watches it, and so does Bekele. And Rupp also in the red of the USA. Masai leads. Tariku Bekele is in second place. Farah and Rupp are together. Then the other Kenyan, Karuki Mukchiri. The other two Ethiopians also still up there in that leading pack, as now we're down to what, 12 men getting away from the rest of the field.
Well, certainly the medalists are going to come from here as Farah moves up onto the shoulder of Tadeko Bekele, just out past his team, his training partner Rupp of the United States, with Masai leading. And this is Bekele is that's Kenenisa Bekele is sitting in behind Mo Farah.
65 and a half second lap, so no real fireworks. They just moved up the tempo a little bit, but as you can see by that big group together, we're just waiting for a major move.
Well, certainly with Great Britain two gold medals on this evening here in London, there could be a third here, because Farah looks very, very sharp indeed. He's prepared well for this. He's come off a world championship and now desperately needs to move it up. He looks comfortable, doesn't he?
So does Rupp on the inside there, Beckley looking round at him. And now Farah takes the lead for the first time. Four laps to go. Masai holding him off, but the pace has slowed again. 67.17, still no major move.
Well, I think that suits Farah, because if it slows, he's got the pace, as I've said several times. And Rupp is having a really good race here. Tactically, he's having a very good race. And I just have a feeling that all of a sudden there's going to be a break. Here comes Medin up very, very quickly indeed. And the Ethiopians now moving up into the lead now. Tariku Bekele follows.
Well, Gebre Meriem, who's bided his time at the back of the pack, has now come right the way up. And the two Bekeles, but that wearing number 9 on his side is Gebre Meriem.
It is indeed Gebre Meriem, and he's been sitting back there and he's waiting to see what the others are going to do. And they're all bunching, and this is a real situation we have here, because in close proximity nobody's prepared to take the early move here. Three laps to go.
Tadesse is still strong on the outside there of Kipsiro. Still no real move, still the pace remains fairly slow. Gebre Meriem, the Ethiopian, has come up to help the Bekeles. Farah and Rupp pretty much together in what, joint third place there for Farah, with Rupp just behind him, and the two Kenyans, Kiroki and Masai there. Lambda Salam is just about to be lapped. Farah just checking round, seeing what's going on. That's Tariku Bekele, the first of the brothers. 25.01, still another 2.46 there. Still no big move.
Well, they've got to be very careful they don't trip each other up here, because this is dangerous time territory indeed. Now then, Farah waits for his moment. The Kenyans bunching again. Tadeko Bekele's there. Kenenisa is still there, but he's blocked in on the inside.
Two laps to go, 12 men in the lead, and Mo Farah shows in front. But the three Eritreans are there, the three Ethiopians are there, and two of the Kenyans are there. Galen Rupp is there. This is a fascinating race. Still no major move. Who is going to go and when? They're poised.
It's a very subtle wind-up of the pace down the back there. Gebre Meriem, you've got in your shot. And Tadesse is still there. He did a lot of that early leading. And I just think Farah is going to make the burst soon. I'm sure he will. He'll have a go at it. Rupp's in close proximity. Here goes Mo Farah now, I think. It's a bit early for him to go and expose his situation now. Who's this coming up wide?
Muchiri of Kenya.
Yeah, it is.
Farah looking smooth, though, just holding his place. Tariku Bekele on the inside. This is just over a lap to go now. Galen Rupp is going well in third place. Muchiri of Kenya, the top Kenyan. Masai's behind him. Tadesse's fighting, so too Medin. It's the bell. Mo Farah hits the bell. 28.36 seconds into this 3,000 metres. We've seen a long sprint for Farah. Can he maintain it? He's got the might of East Africa behind him, plus Galen Rupp just behind. It's Farah who leads, though, with less than a lap to go. Muchiri of Kenya. Bekele, the two Bekeles, with Rupp. They're going away from the rest of the field. It's 200 metres to go now. Mo Farah for Great Britain. Can this be another British gold? Two already today. Farah leads. The field is being spread-eagled. Behind him is Tariku Bekele. Then it's Galen Rupp of the USA. Then Kenenisa Bekele. The other Kenyan looks lost. It's Mo Farah coming down the home straight with Beckley and Rupp. Can it be a 1-2 for the Salazar group? It looks like it. It's Mo Farah takes goal for Great Britain. Gallen Rupp takes second. Then the two Beckley brothers. Behind them, it's Karutmuchi. Then it's Tadesi. Then it's another Ethiopian, Eritrean Ethiopian. But Mo Farah produces the goods and Gallen Rupp takes the silver medal. A last lap of 53.5.
Yeah, they played into his hands, but that is an Olympic champion. The third gold medal for Great Britain on this evening. This will go down as one of the great, great evenings of British athletics, certainly. Mo Farah, forget the time, it doesn't matter. That was about racing. And he can't believe what he's achieved. He's planned so well for this. And at the end of the day, he came good when it mattered. A brilliant, brilliant last lap. Tactically, absolutely sound. It was a very slow first 5,000 metres, a negative split certainly, which meant that it played into the hands. The Africans played into his hands, they really did. They knew what he'd done last year, but Rupp, what a performance by him too. The American, the two training partners have come to these games and got two medals. Well, Alberto Salazar has planned them well, has trained them well, and they've seen them in very good stead, and they have produced the goods for him. And what a night for Britain, for the host nation in these Olympic Games. A wonderful night, three gold medals. Who would have thought that?
Well, it was a fascinating 10,000, a typical championship one. 14.05, the first 5,000, 13.25, the second 5,000 metres. It's a tough way to win, but Mo Farah is a master. He could win off a long sustained surge, or in this case, a fast last lap. And he'll be so pleased that Gallen Rupp has taken the silver. Tariku Bekele took the bronze. Kenenisa Bekele, the great man, not quite good enough this year. And he finished in fourth place. Then Muchiri, then Tadesi, then Medin, then Gebre Mariam. So the might of East Africa has been behind the might of Britain and the might of the USA at the forefront of this 10,000 metres.
Well, it certainly is a change, isn't it? Because Ethiopia have dominated this championship for the last four Olympic Games, and really, it's all changed now. The Britain and the United States, well, Mo has worked it so well, and he truly deserves this. He's not only a world champion, he's an Olympic champion. And he's still got the 5,000 to go.
Indeed, and the first ever British 10,000 metre champion as well. Well, another fascinating race. We had a great women's 10,000 metres. We've had a really fascinating men's 10,000 metres.
It was very, very special. He didn't worry in that first half. He was content with the pace of those up front. And really, at the end, he became... Ah, I think that's the family come to join. It is indeed. Lovely, lovely, lovely moment for Mo. Well done, Dad. And the good lady too. How lovely. Wonderful. A happy man, a happy family, a happy nation. It's absolutely lovely to see. And why not in Britain have the families celebrate together? Remember the preparations for these championships. The family have to give an awful lot away as well. And it's only fair that they should join in here. Here she is. Well done, sir. Well done. Well done indeed. I don't have to tell you, there'll be more pictures on the front pages of the Nationals in the United Kingdom tomorrow. A family photo taken at a very special occasion. An occasion which this young fella will remember for the rest of his days. And the history books will declare him the first British champion. And my goodness me, it is a fantastic occasion.
Well, we've got the one final event, Stuart. We've got the women's 100 metres final. We've seen some great running in the heats. We saw some great running in the semi-final. And this is certainly going to be a race to savour in the final.
Yes, it is. And all the principals are here. Everyone who should be here is here. And I have to say that I have no idea who's going to take this. This is one of those races where you say, well, I'm not sure. let's just have one more look at the final stages of what became a magnificent race in the 10,000 metres. It wasn't about time, it was about tactics, it was about position, it was about everything to do with winning. And that went to Mo Farah of Great Britain. Rhythmic, wonderful celebration towards the end. No one was going to catch him tonight. Marvellous, marvellous, marvellous. This crowd tonight, who were lucky to get the tickets for an evening session, I must say, will have celebrated. And there's another Olympic champion, the second of our Olympic champions tonight, along with Jess Ennis earlier on. And Rupp will celebrate too. The Americans done well. Mo will dance with anyone now. Absolutely anyone.
Well, there's the closing stages. The delight of the winner, the delight of the silver medalist, and the anguish, I think, of the men behind the might of East Africa, the two Beckerley brothers. They ran well, but they couldn't match the finish of Farah or of Rupp. He's done it. He moved to the USA to train there. He's worked out at a high altitude a lot. And it's all come good in a wonderful series of runs over the last few years, since his double European triumph 2 years ago. For Farah, who goes round, and the huge crowd absolutely thrilled by what they've seen here.
Next, it is the final of the 100 meters for women. The very best are here. The defending champion is here. The pretender is here in Carmeleta Jetta. The final of the women's 100 meters promises to be a real star attraction here tonight. The crowd buzzing as the preparations get underway. There are the records. I don't think they'll be surpassed by Florence, the late Florence Griffiths Joyner, world record set in 1988, the year of the Seoul Olympics, of course. There's the lineup. Guillaume Baptiste in lane two, Maria Lahoure, the Ivory Coast, in three, Veronica Campbell-Brown, Jamaica, four, Carmeleta Jetta, USA, five, Blessing Okabara, Nigeria, six, Fraser Price, the defending champion, in seven. Then Alison Felix and Tiana Madison. Let's meet them. Oh, Kellyanne Baptiste, the Trinidadian record holder at 60, 100 and 200. Ran 10.96 in her heat. Ahori, really in good form. Two national records en route to the championship, setting another one here at 10.99. And that was in the first round, qualified with 11.01 to this final. Veronica Campbell-Brown, a Jamaican, twice Olympic champion at 200 metres, the last one Beijing 4 years ago. Second in her semi, 10.89. Will Carmeleta Jetta of the United States prevail? The world champion. She ran 10.83 in her semi-final. The starting absolutely important. Blessing Okabari, watch out for her. She's an Olympic bronze medalist in the long jump in last time, 4 years ago, fifth in the World Championship last year. Her finishing power is awesome. If they let her get close, they could be in trouble. And next to her, in contrast, the defending Olympic champion, qualified with 10.85, Shelly-Ann Fraser-Price. Next to her, the 200 and 400 specialist, eight World Championship golds to her credit. Three at 200, five in relays. She was second in her semi-final in 10.94. Alison Felix. And then Tiana Madison of the United States. World long jump champion back in 2005, turned to sprinting, was second in her heat, 10.92 behind Okabari. So Baptiste, Ahure, Campbell Brown, Jetta, Okabari, Fraser Price, Felix and Madison. The Olympic women's 100 meters final. Jetta last to settle. Well, who gets the start? Fraser Price gets the start. And look at this, Ahure going well. And here they're coming to close it down. Jetta's coming through. But Fraser Price on the near side. The Olympic champion defends. She defends the title. Wonderful run by Sellyann Fraser Price of Jamaica. And it's 10.75. Wow. It needed to. And I think Jetta came through for the silver. But she didn't understand. She didn't know. But yes, she's done it. It was absolutely superb, but this young woman's defended her title. She won it 4 years ago, a diminutive figure, and really at the end of the day you have to say well done to her. It was a terrific final indeed. All the principals were there, they certainly were, but Fraser Price clearly got it. Jetta did get the silver medal in 10.78, a season's best, and Campbell Brown really 10.81, a season's best, to get the bronze. And even fourth place was 10.85 for Madison, and 10.89 was behind that. I mean, what a race! Sub 10.9 all the way. But well, Sellyann Fraser Price, the defending champion, is, well, understandably emotional. She's had her problems too, but Jamaica reigns supreme in the sprints, men and women. The men yet to come, of course, but here is a woman who beat the very best when it mattered. Jetta got the silver, Campbell Brown got the bronze, but the gold with 10.75 goes to Sellyann Fraser Price. She qualified with 10.85, looked as though she'd got more in the tank, and she surely had. Wonderful moments indeed in this Olympic. What an evening, what an evening here in London it's been, and this second session of the second day.
Wonderful standard of sprinting. It's quite cool here now. Okay, the wind conditions are favorable, plus 1.5, but for six women to break 11 seconds, indeed last place going 11.01, Alison Felix did a personal best in fifth place at 10.89, but Fraser Price off fast. And she led all the way and had the strength and speed and determination to hold on to win. And Jetta, pretty pleased, nothing to recriminate her. 10.78 she's run, and she's taken the silver medal.
She's so tiny. In contrast to the men, Jamaica, Usain Bolt is so big, and here you've got the opposite. She's tiny, but her leg speed is terrific. Let's have another look at this. Watch her get out of the blocks, third from the left. She absolutely flies out of the blocks here. Jetta's left. And look at Campbell Brown trying to make some move but can't handle it, overstriding a little bit. Jetta's coming through quite nicely, but Fraser Price is there. She's there. And what a race it was. Another look at it. This was the Olympic final. This was a time 4 years from the last time, the same result. Look at the look on her face. She's looking up at the scoreboard even. Eyes closed, I would think, at that point, but she's won it, and won it very well in the end.
Diminutive figure, but quite long strides for all that. There's the photo and the times there of the first three.
Wow, that was wonderful. Some wonderful finals. Wonderful finals on this evening of this second day of competition, these 2012 Olympic Games. Great Britain, three golds. And Jamaica got one here. China got one in the walk as well earlier on today. But there is the result of the women's 100 metres final. Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce, 10.75. Carmeleta Jetta, 10.78. Veronica Campbell-Brown, 10.81. Look at that. 5 under 10.90. 6 under 11. That is incredible. There's such a lot of Jamaican support in the United Kingdom. Have another look at this. There she is. Looking, coming up very, very slowly. But then looks out. Look at that look, that sheer look of panic on her face. I want this, I want this, I want this. And I've got it. Look at that determination. Superb shot of Fraser-Pryce. And she doesn't know she's won it. She was so focused on her own lane, looking forward, she does not know. And you saw that moment when the realization dawned upon her. She thought perhaps Jetta might have got it. She could sense her there. They could both sense each other, but they never knew. Jetta automatically looked to the right. That was interesting. Campbell Brown on her left. And they didn't know who'd won it at this stage. They really didn't.
But if it was panic on Fraser-Pryce's face, it was control panic for all that. Because this was sheer determination all the way through. Absolutely. Talk about focusing on the target ahead. And all those women there, just look at that for determination.
They're absolutely level.
Ahead.
They're level there, yep. Aren't they? Absolutely
well,
level.
Maybe Fraser-Pryce just ahead, but yeah.
I can't get over the look on her face. That is absolute tension, but with control. She knows what she's doing, and she just realizes eventually, there it is, there was the point. She looks up at the board, up at the big board. I've got it. I am the champion. I didn't know, but I do now. Overcome with emotion. These are big moments. These are very big moments. Ah, look at that. Third from the left. That's a good shot. Ahure went well early on. She was second for a while and then drifted away, but I tell you what, Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce is a worthy Olympic champion for the second time.
Not many people come back and retain titles, and that takes a very special athlete. And of course, she won a world title as well. She is a very special athlete, no question about that. And well, what a collection of medals Veronica Campbell-Brown has got as well. A little overlooking her, but she's got the bronze medal. And she has a huge collection of medals. And we'll see again, of course, these athletes in the 200 metres.
And I think that's where Campbell Brown may well come into her own a little more.
But Felix even more so.
Oh, yes, indeed, yes. Wow, what an evening. Do hope you enjoyed all that. There's a result of the 10,000. Mo Farah, Galen Rupp, Tariku Bekele, Kenenisa Bekele. But what? Look at the scalps of Africa taken by Mo Farah. And, of course, Galen Rupp, well done to him. He was always in the right place at the right time and got a very just reward there. It was marvellous, marvellous.
Well, just running down the whole list of results of that men's 10,000 metres. Wilson Kiprop, the surprise non-finisher there in that race. Just got some good news for Lily Schwarzkopf. She has been reinstated in the heptathlon, so as we thought, she has got the silver medal.
And we've been waiting for the confirmation of the final result of the men's long jump. Rutherford takes gold with 8.31. Mitchell Watt of Australia takes second. And in third place, the American, Will Clay, who takes the bronze medal.
Well, I must say that that if the rest of the Olympic Games are as good as this, then well.
And now we have the victory ceremony for the women's discus. Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the women's discus. Slightly later than it was scheduled, but I think the excitement in the stadium has meant that the discus girls were just held back, but they're going to have their moment. It was a very exciting competition. And tonight we have seen with Sandra Perkovic, who won the gold medal from Croatia, It is their first Olympic gold ever. So a fantastic achievement from the Croatian discus thrower. And presenting the medals this evening.
Guy Drew, Olympic champion, of course, at the high hurdles, member of the IOC now, accompanied by Teddy McCook from Jamaica, IAAF council member.
And one of many athletes, when they finish competing, going into politics, I believe.
Yes, indeed. I ran against Guy Drew several times for Great Britain against France. It's Teddy McCook, the council member for the International Amateur Athletics Federation.
And there be doing the honours and awarding the medals and the bouquets. So the bronze medalist is Li Yongfang Li of China. She took the lead early in the competition, but then was surpassed by the silver medal throws and gold medal throws. But she'd be delighted with that, and she caresses and kisses that medal. She was the world champion in 2011. Pishchalnikova takes the silver medal from Russia. A throw of 67 meters 56 takes the silver medal. She was the world lead coming into this meeting, but she'll have to go away with silver this evening. And the gold medalist and Olympic champion, winning Croatia's first ever gold medal, is Sandra Perković. 69 meters 11. And it's a new Croatian record too, to go to boot. In 2010, she became the youngest ever European champion and then won it again in Barcelona earlier this year. So the gold medalist in the women's discus, Perković from Croatia. And the crowd salute the new Olympic champion in the women's discus, Perković from Croatia. All three medalists proudly displaying their medals on the top of the rostrum. The crowd have had a fantastic feast of athletics this evening in the Olympic Stadium.
And according to the schedule, we have one more victory ceremony to come. The men's 10,000 meters will be, I think, tomorrow, as indeed the men's long jump. But we have the women's heptathlon ceremony.
all lining up, all chewing the medals. They do look fantastic medals that the LOCOG committee have come up with for this year's games, and they'll be treasured for the rest of their lives.
Crowd have just seen on the scoreboard at the end of the arena the result of the heptathlon, revised now with Schwarzkopf back in the silver medal position. Well, it would have been extremely harsh at any way of looking at it if she had been disqualified for what could only have been a minor infringement of the 800 meters, but she is back in silver medal position, and the crowd seeing that that is going to be the final presentation here with the Beatles' great anthem, All You Need Is Love, ringing out in the arena.
That is Paul McCartney, actually, in the middle of your screen.
How appropriate, the co-writer of this great song. All You Need Is Love.
Yes.
Paul's with us. With Stella McCartney, who designed the British outfit, his daughter. Revised result for the 800 meters, with Lily Schwarzkopf back in the result of the 800 meters. She was initially disqualified, having come fourth at 2:10.50, but she's been reinstated after discussions with the referee, and that means that she is back in the silver medal position. So here is the result of the heptathlon, which I trust is now the final one. Jessica Rennis winning the gold medal with 6.955 points. Lily Schwarzkopf taking silver at 6.649. Cheneva the bronze at 6.628. Those last two coming up from fifth and sixth, coming into this seventh and final event of the 800 meters. Full result there, the brilliant young British athlete, Johnson Thompson, 6.267 points as well. She She's certainly an athlete to look for the future, because she's smashed the British junior record, which was held by Jessica Ennis. A few non-starters, as we always have there, of course. So certainly all the people here today have witnessed the night of athletics that they will never forget. Five sets of medals determined, and three gold medals went to Great Britain. One of the greatest days in the history of the country's sport, and here in London as well. So a little bit of rabble-rousing by the infield announcer here.
I tell you what, there'll be stories told to grandchildren for years to come by saying, I was here. The second day of the Olympic Games, the 4th of August, 2012, I was here. I witnessed some athletics history for Great Britain. What a privilege to have been here to see the performances tonight. It was absolutely magnificent. Crowd being entertained on the big scoreboards, the highlights of the evening's athletics, right from the very beginning, from the 400 meter hurdles right the way through to the women's 100 meters. A chance to reflect on some wonderful competition. Absolutely marvelous evening. Well, a lot to celebrate from Team Great Britain. There'll be other nights, but this was a very special night for this public here that have come in force. The crowds and the atmosphere in this stadium I've not seen before. I've said that before on another evening, but with 10 Olympic Games under my belt, I can tell you that this is very, very special. Very special. Crowd patiently waiting for what we think will be a final medal presentation to celebrate one of the British gold medals won here in this second session of the second day of these Olympic Games.
Well, undoubtedly one of the great nights in Olympic history, not least for hometown support. One thinks of the Tuesday in Sydney, when of course Kathy Freeman won, and there were so many other great feats as well with Gebrselassie and Edwards. But now we come to the victory ceremony for the heptathlon, which has been so long awaited, so keenly anticipated by enthusiasts throughout the country of Britain, and indeed around the world, I guess, because the figure that's resembled, that particularly has been concentrated on for the athletics events, has been Jessica Ennis. And it's like Kathy Freeman in Australia, to have all the expectation, but actually to deliver, and to deliver in such style, and indeed by a huge victory margin, takes a very special person indeed. And it has come to force here today in London, as you said, Stuart, on the 4th of August. David Hemery, yeah, a great champion, the Mexico Olympic champion, 48-1-2 is world record there. He smashed the world record up in Mexico City. Glad that he was here today to see a great day for British athletics.
Yes, some members of the royal family, the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge, hanging on to watch this medal ceremony, which is very special. A young woman whose life after today will change dramatically. A crowd anticipating another moment at which they can deliver their excitement, their applause, their appreciation. Here we go, here we go.
Here we come then, the heptathlon victory ceremony. As they step out into the arena, the mass ranks of the crowds here can see who they are. They know the result, of course, already, but a very special moment now when the medals are presented.
And she's performed fantastically across all seven events, throws, jumps, running.
Well, very fitting that the medal should be presented by Craig Reedy, who's the British member of the IOC, and he's accompanied by Lord Sebastian Coe, IF Vice President, but also, of course, very much the man behind these Olympic Games. So great that these two great figures of British sport should make the presentations. A great cheer for Sebastian Coe.
An Olympic champion twice over in his own right.
So the world champion of last year, now the Olympic bronze medalist, came through with a fine 800 meters run to come from sixth into third place, Tatjana Chernova. Silver medalist had to suffer some agonizing moments, initially disqualified from the final event, reinstated and well deserving the silver medal. Lilly Schwarzkopf of Germany. Excellent scores of over 6,600 points by the bronze and silver medalists, but the gold medalist was 300 and more points ahead of them. Just listen to the roar. The moment of her life, Jessica Ennis. Gold medalist. Well, I've never heard a national anthem sung at an Olympic victory ceremony with such fervor before. Thousands upon thousands of flashes around the stadium as the people in the crowd here capture this moment that they'll remember forever. Well, that concludes the action here from a wonderful night of athletics. Good night.